And thus also did Rehoboam speak to the elders of Israel. And the people all rose up together in their full number, and they said, Get back to your houses, O Israel. Have we none else whom we can make king, save in the house of Judah and in the house of Benjamin? We will reject their houses and the men of both of them, and we will make as our king and governor the man whom we wish for in, and in whom our soul delighteth. And they took up their weapons of war and fled in a body and came to the city of Samaria of Beth Ephratah, where they took counsel and were gathered together in a body. And the house of Israel cast lots among themselves so that they might make king the man whom they choose from the house of the father of the man wherein the lot fell. And the lot fell on the house of Ephraim, on the son of Nabat. And they chose a man from his house of his father and made Jeroboam king. And thus was the kingdom separated from Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, and there was left to it only the house of Benjamin and the house of Judah his father. And the word which God spake to David his servant was not made a lie. Of the fruit of thy body I will make to sit upon thy throne. And again he said, Ordained like the moon forever. And again he said, God sware to David truly and will not repent. He who reigned on the throne of David his father was Jesus Christos, his kinsman in the flesh by a virgin, who sat upon the throne of his Godhead, and upon earth he granted to reign upon his throne the king of Ethiopia, Solomon's firstborn. To Rehoboam God gave only two stems, and the king of Rome is the youngest son of Solomon. And God did this in order that the foolish people might not call us Jews because of Solomon and because of Rehoboam, his son. Now God knoweth the heart, and he did this that they may not imagine such a thing. They called Rehoboam king of Judah, and they called the king of Samaria king of Israel. And of the generations of Rehoboam, from Rehoboam to Eliakim, were 41 generations. And there were born to Melchi two children, Levi and Shem, the begetter of Honasseh. And Honasseh begot Calamios, and Calamios begot Joashim. And Joashim begot Mary, the daughter of David. And again, Eli begot Malchi, and Malchi begat Mattai, and Mattai begot Eli and Jacob, and Hannah the wife of Joashim. And Eli took a wife and died without children. And Jacob took to wife Yehoda, the wife of Eli, and he begot by her Joseph the carpenter, who was the betrothed of Mary. And Joseph was the son of Jacob in the flesh, and the son of Eli according to the law. Now God had commanded Moses that the Israelites were to marry their kinsfolk, each in the house of his fathers, and that they were not to marry alien women. Concerning Mary, the daughter of Zion, the daughter of David. And from this it is evident that Mary was the daughter of David, and that Joseph was the son of David. Therefore was Mary betrothed to Joseph, her kinsman. As it is said in the gospel, O Joseph, son of David, fear thou not to take to wife Mary, thy betrothed. For that which is to be born of her is of the Holy Spirit, the Word of God. And there was born of her God, the Word, light of light, God of God, Son of the Father, who came and delivered his creation from the hand of Sheol and from Satan, and from death he hath delivered all of us who have believed in him. He hath drawn us to his Father, and hath raised us up into heaven his throne to become his heirs. For he is a lover of man, and to him praise belongeth forever. Amen. Concerning the king of Rome, Constantinople. And we will begin to tell you what we have heard, and what we have found written, and what we have seen concerning the king of Rome. The kingdom of Rome was the portion and dominion of Japhet, the son of Noah. And sitting down, they made 12 great cities. And Darius built the greatest city of their kingdoms, Antioch, Dicyria, and Bartonia, and Ramia, Roma, and those who reigned dwelt there. The king Constantine built Constantinople after his own name. Now the sign of the cross having appeared to him during the battle in the form of stars cut in the heavens, he was delivered out of the hands of his enemy. And from that time onwards, the king of Rome made their habitation there. And that Darius had many descendants, and from Darius to the days of Solomon were 18 generations. And of his seed was born a man whose name was Sambaris, and he made in wisdom a drawing of the Astrolabe, and placed stars therein, and he made also a balance, a clock, for the sun, and before saw what would come after, and that the kingdom would not remain to the children of Japheth, but would depart to the seed of David, of the tribe of Shem. And when he thus saw, he sent a message to David the king, saying, "Take my daughter for thy son." And David the king took her and gave her to Solomon his son. And Solomon begot a son by her and called his name Adrami. And Sambaris died before this. And Baltasar, who was his kinsman, became king. And he lacked male offspring to reign after him upon his throne. And he was jealous lest the children of his father should reign after him. And he sent a written message to Solomon the king, saying, "Hail to the greatness of thy kingdom, and to thine honorable wisdom. And now, give me thy son, whom I will make king over the city of Rome, for I have not been able to beget male children, but only three daughters. And I will give him whichever of my daughters he pleaseth, and I will give him my throne, and he shall be king, he and his seed after him, in the city of Rome forever." And when King Solomon had read this letter, he meditated, saying, "If I keep back my son, he will send to the king of the east, who will give him his son, and that which I have planned will be made void. Therefore, I will give him my son." And he took counsel with his counselors of the house of Israel, and he said to them, "We have already given our son and our children to the country of Ethiopia, and Israel hath a kingdom there. And now, so that we may have a third kingdom, the country of Rome, I will send thither thither Adramis, my youngest son. Hold ye not it against me as an evil thing that formerly I took away your sons, for it is a pleasing thing to God that the men of Ethiopia have learned his name and have become his people. In like manner, the men of Rome, if we give them our children, will become the people of God, and to us, moreover, shall be given the name of the people of God, being spoken of and called thus. The people of Israel have taken the kingdom of Ethiopia and the kingdom of Rome. Give ye your youngest sons as before ye gave the eldest, and let those of the middle age stay in our city." And they rose up and took counsel and returned and said to him, "We will speak this matter to the king, and he shall do his will." And he said to them, "Make me hear what ye would say." And they said to him, "Thou hast already taken the eldest of our houses, and now take the youngest of their children." And he was pleased with this counsel, and he did for them as they wished. And he set forward Adrami his son, who took some of the nobles of the lower grades of the house of Israel, and lot fell upon him in the name of his father Solomon, and they gave him a priest of the tribe of the Levites, whose name was Achimael. And they set Adrami upon the king's mule, and cried out to him, "Hail, long live the royal father." And all the people said, "It is right and proper." And they anointed him with the oil of kingship, and commanded him to keep all the laws of the kingdom. And they made him to swear that he would worship no other god except the God of Israel. And they blessed him as they had blessed David his brother, and admonished Adrami even as they had admonished David. And they accompanied him on his way as far as the sea coast. And Solomon the king wrote and sent a letter, saying, "Peace be to Belteshazzar, the king of Rome. Take my son Adrami, and give him thy daughter, and make him king in the city of Rome. Thou didst wish for a king of the seed of David, my father, and I have done thy will, and I have sent to thee his nobles, 14 on his right hand and 14 on his left, who shall keep the law with him and be subject to thee according to thy will." And they arrived there with the ambassadors of the king of Rome, together with much splendor and all the equipment that was requisite for the country of Rome. And they came to the city of Rome to Belteshazzar the king, and they repeated all that Solomon had sent them to say, and delivered over to him his son. And Belteshazzar rejoiced exceedingly and gave him his eldest daughter, whose name was Adlonia. And he made a great marriage feast according to the greatness of his kingdom, and established him over all the city of Rome. And he blessed him, for he was noble in stature, and his wisdom was marvelous, and he was exceedingly mighty in his strength. And one day Balthasar wished to test his knowledge in the trying of cases, a man, the possessor of a vineyard, having come to him and appealed to him, saying, "My lord, Arsani, the son of Yodat, hath transgressed thy word, and hath laid waste my vineyard with his sheep. And behold, I have seized his sheep, and they are in my house. What decision wilt thou come to in respect of me?" And the owner of the sheep came to the king and made an appeal to him, saying, give me back my sheep, for he hath carried them off because they went into his vineyard." And the king said to them, "Go ye and argue your case before your king Adrami, and whatsoever he shall say to you, that do." And they went and argued their case before him. And Adrami asked him, saying, "How much of the vineyard have the sheep eaten? The leaves or the tendrils, or the young grapes, or the shoots by the roots?" And the owner of the vineyard answered and said to him, "They have eaten the tendrils and the branches that had grapes upon them, and there is nothing left of the vine except the twigs by the root." And Adrami asked the owner of the sheep, saying, Is this true?" And the owner of the sheep answered and said to him, "My lord, they ate only the tendrils with leaves on them." And Adrami answered and said, "This man saith that they ate the grapes. Is this true?" And the owner of the sheep answered and said, "No, my lord, but they ate the blossoms before they had formed into grapes." Concerning the first judgment of Adrami, king of Rome. And Adrami said to them, "Hearken ye to the judgment which I will declare to you. If the sheep have destroyed all the shoots from the root of the vine, then they all belong to thee. And if they have eaten the leaves of the branches and the blossoms of the grape, take the sheep. Shear their wool, and take also the young of those which have not yet brought forth. But the sheep which have already brought forth young for the first time, leave to the owner of the sheep." And all those who heard the judgment which he pronounced marveled. And Balthasar said, "Verily, this judgment is a judgment of the people of the God of Israel. Henceforward, judge him that hath a case at law. Wage war with him that would wage war. Rule him that would be ruled, keep alive him that should be kept alive, and pass that would be ruled, pass judgment that ought to be passed, according as men would be judged, and take this city to thyself and to thy seed after thee." And all the men of the city of Rome were well pleased, and they made Adrami king over them. And they rejoiced in him with a great joy, for it happened thus by their will and by the will of God. And then a fever seized Balthasar, and thereupon he sent Adrami to war, and into everything that he wished, whilst he himself reigned in the city. And after this Balthasar died, and Adrami directed the kingdom. And the city of Rome became the possession of Adrami and of his generations after him. For by the will of God the whole of the kingdom of the world was given to the seed of Shem, and slavery to the seed of Ham, and the handicrafts to the seed of Japheth. Concerning the king of Midian. The king of Midian was the seed of Shem, for of the seed of Isaac was Esau, who went forth from his mother's womb with Jacob clinging to the sole of his foot. And Jacob carried away the right of the firstborn from Esau for the sake of a mess of pottage. And the name of Esau's kingdom was called according to his name of contempt, Edom, for the interpretation of Edom is Lentiles. And because of this, the seed of Esau were called Edomites. For through the greed of his belly he forsook and lost the right of the firstborn of the seed of Shem. For unless the soul be restrained by temperance, it will bring down into a net the whole of the last of the belly, which is of the body. For the body is greedy, but temperance restraineth the soul. And therefore Paul said, "That which the soul doth not wish, the body wisheth, and that which the body doth not wish, the soul wisheth. And each contendeth against the other. If a man willeth a thing, and his soul bandeth itself with the desire of his body, he becometh like the devil. But if he restraineth his body, and his soul bandeth itself with his desire, he becometh like Christ. For the apostles say that Christ is the head of every man who traveleth upon the straight road, And our Lord said to his disciples, Walk in the Spirit, and perform ye not the lust of your bodies. And when they heard this, they forsook all the lust of the flesh. And they said to our Lord, Behold now, we have forsaken everything and followed thee. What is our reward? And our Savior said to them, Ye have made your bodies like to those of angels, and shall do mighty deeds, even as I do. And behold, I have given you authority to raise the dead, and I have given you the power to heal the sick, and ye shall trample upon all the power of the enemy. And at my second coming ye shall judge and shall put to shame the 12 tribes of Israel, because they have not believed on me, and have treated my glory with contempt. And as for those who believe in me, ye shall magnify them, and shall make them to rejoice with you in my kingdom. Concerning the king of Babylon. Now the king of Babylon is of the seed of Shem, and he will show you clearly that the king of Babylon is of the seed of Shem. It came to pass in the days of old that there lived in the kingdom of Manasseh, the king of Israel, a certain man whose name was Carmin, and he was a fearer of God, and he gave many alms and oblations to the poor of Israel. And when he made offerings to the house of God, he did so with sincerity, and his tithe he gave twofold. And he was good in all his ways, and there was no evil whatsoever before him. And Satan, the enemy of all good, became envious of him, for he saw that his course of life was good, and that man was exceedingly rich in camels and horses, and flocks of sheep, and herds of cattle, and gold and silver, and fine apparel. And he used to feed the mule of the king in the Armathan, a city of Israel. Now his native place was the country of Judah, his father's portion, but because of his love for wealth, he departed into Armathan to dwell there. And Israel allowed him to settle this there because of his riches, for he was exceedingly rich and had many possessions. And the governors of Judah were afraid of him. Concerning lying witnesses. And there was a certain depraved man of the seed of Benjamin, whose name was Benias, who used to lead the mule of the king of Israel, and Carmin used to feed him, together with the mule of King Manasseh. And among the neighbors of Carmin, there were certain men who were envious of him because of his pastures and wells, and because of the multitudes of his flocks and herds and servants. For the region where he had settled was the inheritance of their fathers, and for this reason they wished to drive him away from their country. And they kept watch upon Benias, the leader of the king's mule, with evil intent. And they abused Carmin and said to Benias, This Carmin blasphemeth, and he hath blasphemed the king of Israel, the anointed of God, saying, This king is not the son of a free woman, but the son of an old woman, servant whom a certain man bought for 2 core measures of grain to work at the mill and brick making. Do thou take thy case against him to the king and accuse him, for we will be thy witnesses before the king, and we will not let to him that they would bear false witness against Carmin, by whose tongue such a word had never been uttered, and into whose mind such a thought had never entered. Do thou take thy case against him to the king and accuse him, for we will be thy witnesses before the king, and we will not let thee be put to shame. And they made a covenant together, and they swore to him that they would bear false witness against Carmin, by whose tongue such a word had never been uttered, and into whose mind such a thought had never been entered. And Benias went to his lord, the king, and told him all this matter. And the king said to him, Is there any man who hath heard this with thee? And Benias answered and said to him, Yea, there are some who have heard, 2 of the nobles of Israel who belong to Armathan. And the king said to him, Go now and bring them hither secretly, so that we may find out whether they agree with thy words. And if they do so, we will cut off the head of Carmin. And Benias departed and brought Sarios and Carmelos of the tribe of Manasseh. For it had been agreed between them that they would not put him to shame before the king in the matter of their lying testimony. And these 2 men agreed together and planned when they were on their way, saying, When we have spoken to the king, if he shall ask us afterwards separately, so that he may find out the truth of our words, saying, Where did you hear these words? We will each of us answer and say to him, When we were drinking wine with him, and when he shall say to us, What day was this? We shall say, 5 days after the new moon. And when he saith to us, What time of the day? We will say to him, At the ninth hour, when he was sitting with us, and we were drinking wine together. And when he shall ask us, saying, What did you drink out of? And where were you sitting? We will say to him, Out of cups of gold, and our seats were in the hall of his house, where the cushions for reclining upon were placed. And they agreed together on this evil plot, while as they were on their way. And when they arrived in the presence of the king, Banias brought them forward. And the king questioned them, and they repeated to him all their lying counsel. And he asked them according as they had surmised, and on the road, the occasion, and the day, and the hour of their drinking wine, and their sitting in the hall. And they told him, Now God hath commanded that kings and governors and all those who occupy a high position shall investigate an accusation, even as God commanded Moses. And when the king had inquired into all this matter, he called the captain of his host, who stood before him, and said to him, Go at dawn of day tomorrow, and surround the house of Carmen, and let not any one of his people escape thee, neither man nor woman, and slay them all with the sword. And as for Carmen, cut off his head, and bring hither all his possessions, and his goods, and all his flocks and herds, and his gold and silver. And those liars rejoiced and returned to their district, and they went into the house of Carmen, and held converse with him with words of peace, and they paid him compliments, and they made jest before his face, evil being in their hearts. And then was fulfilled on them the prophecy of David, who said, Those who speak words of peace with their neighbor and have evil in their hearts, reward them according to the evil of their works and according to the evil of their thoughts. And they drank themselves drunk in the house of Carmen, and they slept together with him. And when they had fallen asleep, behold, the angel of God was sent to Carmen, and he awoke him and said to him, Leave all thy possessions and save thyself, for men have been commanded by Manasseh the king to cut off thy head. Take as much as thy riches as thou canst carry, and flee into another country, for this Manasseh is a slayer of the prophets and a seeker after the blood of innocent men. Then Carmen rose up straightway and sought out this treasure in gold and took it. And he awoke with his wife and his two sons, and he also awoke his chosen servants and loaded them with possessions of great value and went forth by night. And he sent off his wife and his sons with two of his servants to go to Jerusalem, and departed with two of his servants to a remote country, a distance of 3 months' journey, and he arrived at Babylon. And he came to Balaam, the king of Babylon, and gave him a gift, and related to him what had happened to him. And Balaam loved Carmen, and gave him a habitation near the house of his merchant, who had departed to a far country for a period of 3 years. And those men who had borne lying testimony, they killed in bed in Carmen's house. And the wife of the merchant loved Carmen, and she was seduced by him, and became with child. Now the behavior of a woman is bad. And the husband of the woman had left her when she was with child, and she brought forth and gave to the child to a nurse who brought it up. And in the second year she went astray and became with child by Carmen. For the person of Carmen was exceeding goodly in Israel, and the woman wished to throw the child whom she had conceived into the river when he was born, and to wait for the merchant her husband as if he had not gone astray, and had not done anything wrong, even as Solomon the wise man said, There are three things which are difficult to me in my mind, and the fourth of these I cannot comprehend: the track of the eagle in the heavens, the path of the serpent on the rock, the track of a ship on the sea. Now the fourth of them of which he speaks concerneth the wicked woman, who having wronged her husband, and washed herself, sitteth down like a woman who hath done nothing. And she sweareth an oath falsely. And at that time the wife of Balaam, the king of Babylon conceived and brought forth something which was like to an eagle, a perfect bird, but altogether without wings. And she called a handmaiden who was a favorite, and sent the thing away in a wicker basket, and commanded her to cast it into the sea, without river, without letting anyone know about it. And the time for the bringing forth of the wife of the merchant arrived, and she brought forth a man-child, comely in form and worthy of compassion. And without suckling it, she called to a handmaiden who was a favorite, and put it into the inner part of a box, and commanded her to throw him into the sea, a river, without anyone knowing about it. For she was afraid of her husband. And in the same night two women brought forth the merchant's wife and the wife of the king. And at daybreak the two women sent their handmaidens to cast their children into the river. And by the will of God, these two handmaidens met each other before they had thrown the children into the river, and they talked together. And the handmaiden of the king asked the handmaiden of the merchant, saying, "What is in thy box?" And she showed her the beautiful child. And the king's handmaiden said to her, "Why hast thou brought him here?" And the merchant's handmaiden said to her, "Because the wife of my lord hath gone astray with a certain Israelite, and she conceived and brought forth a child, and she hath commanded me to throw him into the river." And the king's handmaiden said to her, "Why doth she not bring up a child who is so beautiful?" And the merchant's handmaiden said to her, "Her husband left her with child, and she brought forth a child and is rearing him. How then can she rear this child who is of strange and alien seed?" And the merchant's handmaiden asked the king's handmaiden, saying, What hast thou in thy box?" And the king's handmaiden said to her, "My lady hath brought forth a child that hath not the appearance of a man, but of a wingless eagle, and she hath commanded me to throw it into the river. And now give me this child of thine, that I may give it to my mistress. And do thou take this bird and cast it into the river." And they did so. And the handmaiden of the king took the child of Carmen to her mistress, and the queen rejoiced. And it was reported to the king that the queen had borne a son. And the queen gave the boy to the nurses. And he grew up in the house of the king. And she called his name Nebuchadnezzar, which is being interpreted by the luck of the bird. And through this, it is well known that the king of Babylon is the seed of Shem, and he came and overthrew Jerusalem by the will of God, and he carried away captive the children of Israel, and he made them to wander in the town of Babylon with the grandchildren of Manasseh, and Lai was so very rich that he set up a pillar of gold on the plain of Babylon, 60 cubits high. And he was very arrogant. And he used to say, "I make the sun to shine in the heavens." And he worshipped idols. And God abased him so that he might know him. And he set his portion with the beast of the field. And when he knew the name of the Lord, after 7 years he had compassion upon him, and brought him back in repentance. And the kingdom of Babylon was his, and it belonged to those who were of his seed forever. Concerning the king of Persia. The king of Persia, in likewise of the seed of Shem, and we will inform you concerning the matters that relate to him. Judah begot two sons, and he brought in Tamar for his eldest son, and he died. And Judah sent his younger son to her, that he might raise up seed to his brother by his brother's wife. And he did that which God hated, and he did not wish to raise up seed to his brother, as his father Judah had commanded him. Now, when he lay with Tamar, he made his seed to go into the ground, so that it might not germinate in her womb and be called the seed of his brother. But he wished to raise up seed by his own wife in his own name. And when God saw his evil act, he turned his face away from him and slew him. And Judah, the father-in-law of Tamar, brought her back and set her in the house of her father, and said to her kinsfolk, "Keep carefully this Israelitish woman, and let her not defile herself with an alien, for I will have a little son. And if God will let him grow up, I will give him to her." And while his Tamar was living as a widow in her father's house, behold, Judah, her father-in-law, came to the place where his sheepfolds were to shear wool with great satisfaction and pleasure. And when Tamar heard that her father-in-law had come, she cast away from her the apparel of widowhood, and she put herself in splendid apparel, and she viled herself after the manner of a harlot, and she followed him that sat down. And he sent a message to her, saying, I wish to accompany with thee. And she said to him, What wilt thou give me for my hire? And she said to her, I will send to thee in the morning early a sucking lamb. And she said to him, Give me a pledge until thou givest me the lamb. And he gave her his staff and ring and the close-fitting cap that was under his headdress. And he accompanied her with her, and she took things and departed to her house. And he sent the lamb to her early in the morning. And his servants inquired and said, Where is the house of the harlot? And they said to him, There is no harlot in our town. And they returned into their city and told him that there was no harlot in their town. And Judah said, Leave ye it, the will of God be done. Then Tamar conceived, and they told her father-in-law that she had conceived. And he went and took the elders of Israel to the father of Tamar. And he said to him, Bring to me thy daughter who hath conceived, that we may stone her with stones, even as Moses commanded, for she hath brought reproach upon the house of Israel. And the father and kinsfolk of Tamar told her that her father-in-law spake thus. And she brought out the ring and the staff and the cap and gave them to her father and her kinsfolk. And she said to them, The owner of these things hath seduced me. Let them stone me with him with stones. And when Judah saw his possessions, he recognized them, and he said, Tamar is more righteous than I. And he left her and came to his house. And Tamar brought forth twins, two nations, Perez, Phares, and Zarah. And Phares, Persia, was founded in the name of Phares, and he ruled over it and his seed after him, and they were called Pharsawian, Persians. Behold now, it is proved that the king of Persia is of the seed of Shem. And then, when he had completed the establishing of the law, they made, according to what they had seen in Jerusalem, the law in the house of Zion for the nobles of the kingdom, and for those who were inside, and for those that were outside, and for the people, and for the islands, and for the cities, and for the provinces, and for all the inhabitants, and for all their tribal kinsfolk. They made ordinances in the same manner. And thus the eastern boundary of the kingdom of the king of Ethiopia is the beginning of the city of Gaza, in the land of Judah, that is, Jerusalem. And its boundary is the lake of Jericho, and it passeth on by the coast of its sea to Leba and to Saba, and its boundary goeth down to Bisis and Ashnet, and its boundary is the sea of the blacks and the naked men, and goeth up Mount Kebreneon into the sea of darkness, that is to say, the place where the sun setteth, and its boundary extendeth to Phenel and Lasiphala, and its border are the lands near the garden, paradise, where there is food in plenty and abundance of cattle, and near Phenicin, and its boundary reacheth as far as Sawel, and passeth on the sea of India, and its boundary is as far as the sea of Tarsus, and in its remote part lieth the sea of Midian, until it cometh to the country of Gaza. And its boundary is the place where our enumeration began. And moreover, the dominion of the king of Ethiopia belongeth to him and to his seed forever. How the men of Rome destroyed the faith. And after they had waited for 3 months, now Zion came into the country of Ethiopia at the beginning of the first month, in the language of the Hebrews, and in Greek, Tarmon, and in Gittis, Ethiopic, Meyasia. On the sixth or seventh day, they wrote down the law and the names, and they deposited the writing for a memorial for the later days, so that what was right should be done for the pavilion of Zion thereby, and so that the glory of the kings of Ethiopia and the glory of the kings of Rome might be well known. For the kings of Ethiopia and the kings of Rome were brethren and held the Christian faith. Now, first of all, they believed in an orthodox manner in the preaching of the apostles up to the time of Constantine and Helena, the queen, who brought forth the wood of the cross. And they, the kings of Rome, continued to believe 130 years. And afterwards, Satan, who hath been the enemy of man from old, rose up and seduced the people of the country of Rome, and they corrupted the faith of Christ, and they introduced heresy into the church of God by the mouth of Nestorius and Arius and Yabaso, where into those hearts he cast the same jealousy as he had cast into the heart of Cain to slay his brother Abel. In like manner did their father, the devil, the enemy of righteousness and the hater of good, cast jealousy, even as David said, "They speak violence in the heights of heaven, and set their mouths in the heavens, and their tongues waggeth on the earth." And those same men, who not whence they came, and know not whither they are going, revile their Creator with their tongues, and blaspheme his glory, while he is God, and the word of the Lord. He came down from the throne of his Godhead and put on the body of Adam, and he is God, the Word, and in that body he was crucified so that he might redeem Adam in his iniquity. And he went up into the heavens and sat upon the throne of his Godhead in that body which he had taken. And he shall come again in glory to judge the living and dead, and shall reward every man according to his work, and forever and ever. Amen. And we believe thus, and we adore the Holy Trinity, and those who do not believe thus are excommunicated by the Word of God, the King of heaven and earth, both in this world and in that world which is to come. And we are strong in the orthodox faith which the fathers, the apostles, have delivered to us, the faith of the church. And thus Ethiopia continued to abide in her faith until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christus, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. The first war of the king of Ethiopia. And after 3 months, they, David and his soldiers, rose up to wage war from the city of the government, with Makeda his mother and Zion his lady. And the Levites carried the tabernacle of the law, together with the things that appertaineth to their office, and they marched along with great majesty. And as in times of old, when God on Mount Sinai made Zion to come down in holiness to Moses and Aaron, even so did Azariah and Elmias bear along the tabernacle of the law. And the other mighty men of Israel marched on the right side of it, and on the left, and close to it, and before it, and behind it. And although they were beings made of dust, they sang psalms and songs of the Spirit like the heavenly host. And God gave them beautiful voices and marvelous songs, for he was well pleased to be praised by them. And they came from the city of the government, and encamped at Maya Abau. And on the following morning they laid waste the district of Sawa with Hadea, for enmity had existed between them from olden time. And they blotted out the people and slew them with the edge of the sword. And they passed on from that place and encamped at Gera. And here also they laid waste the city of vipers that had the faces of men, and the tails of asses attached to their loins. And the queen returned and encamped in the city of Zion, and they remained therein 3 months. Then their wagons moved on and came to the city of the government. And in one day they came to the city of Saba, and they laid waste Noba. And from there they camped round about Saba, and they laid waste as far as the border of Egypt. And the majesty, or awe, of the king of Ethiopia was so great that the king of Midian and the king of Egypt caused gifts to be brought to him. And they came to the city of government, and from there they encamped in Abat, and they waged the war on the country of India. And the king of India brought a gift and a present or tribute, and himself did homage to the king of Ethiopia. He, David, waged the war wheresoever he pleased. No man conquered him. On the contrary, whosoever attacked him was conquered, And as for those who would have played the spy in his camp in order to hear some story and relate it in their city, they were unable to run by the wagons, for Zion herself made the strength of the enemy to be exhausted. But King David with his soldiers, and the armies of the soldiers, and all those who obeyed his word, ran by the wagons without pain or suffering, and without hunger or thirst, and without sweat or exhaustion, and traveled in one day a distance which usually took 3 months to traverse. And they lacked nothing whatsoever of the things which they asked God through Zion, the tabernacle of the law of God, to give them. For he dwelt with her, and his angel directed her, and she was his habitation. And as for the king who ministered to his pavilion, if he were traveling on any journey and wished something to be done, everything that he wished for and thought about in his heart and indicated with his finger, everything I say was performed at his word. And everyone feared him, but he feared no one, for the hand of God was with him. And it protected him by day and by night, and he did his will. And God worked for him and protected him from evil forever and ever. Amen. This I found among the manuscripts of the Church of Sophia in the Constantinople, and the archbishops who were there said to Domitius, this is that what is written from the days of Solomon the king, and Domitius of Antioch said, yea, that which is written up to the day of the death of Solomon is to be accepted, and that which hath been written by other prophets after his death is to be accepted likewise. How the honorable estate of the king of Ethiopia was universally accepted. Now, through the Kebra-Nagast, we know and have learned that of a surety the king of Ethiopia is honorable, and that he is the king of Zion, and the firstborn of the seed of Shem, and that the habitation of God is in Zion, and that he there breaketh the might and power of all his enemies and foes. And after him the king of Rome was the anointed of the Lord because of the wood of the cross. And as concerning the kingdom of Israel, when the pearl was born of them, and of the pearl again was born the Son of Righteousness, who hid himself in her body, now had he not hidden himself in the body of a man, he could not have been by mortal eyes, and having put on our body, he became like to us. And he walked about with men, and we wrought signs and wonders in their midst. He raised their dead, and he healed their sick folk, and he made the eyes of their blind to see, and he opened the ears of their deaf to folk, and he cleansed the lepers, and he satisfied the hungry with food, and he performed the many miracles, some of which were written down, and some of which are not, even as saith John the Evangelist, the son of Zebedee. If everything which Jesus did were written down, the whole world would not be able to hold all the writings that would have to be written. And when the wicked children of Israel saw all this, they thought that he was a man, and they were envious of him because of what they saw and heard, and they crucified him upon the wood of the cross, and they killed him. And he rose from the dead on the third day, and went up into heaven in glory, and sat on the throne of the Godhead. And he received from the Father a kingdom incorruptible forever and ever, over the beings of the spirit and the beings of earth, and over every created being, so that every tongue shall adore his name, and every knee bow to him. And he shall judge the living and the dead, and reward every man according to his work. So therefore, when the Jews shall see him, they shall be put to shame, and shall be condemned to the fire which is everlasting. But we who believe in the orthodox faith shall be upon our throne, and we shall rejoice with our teachers, the apostles, provided that we walk in the way of Christ and in his commandments. And after the Jews crucified the Savior of the world, they were scattered abroad, and their kingdom was destroyed, and they were made an end of and rooted out forever and ever. And all the saints who were gathered together said, assuredly, in very truth, the king of Ethiopia is more exalted and more honorable than any other king upon the earth, because of the glory and greatness of the heavenly Zion. And God loveth the people of Ethiopia, for without knowing about his law, They destroyed their idols, whereas those to whom the law of God had been given made idols and worshiped the gods which God hated. And in the later times, when he was born to redeem Adam, he wrought signs and wonders before them. But they did not believe in him, neither in his preaching, nor in the preaching of his fathers. But the people of Ethiopia believed in one trustworthy disciple. And for this reason, God hath loved exceedingly the people of Ethiopia. And the bishops answered and said to him, Gregory, well hast thou spoken, and thy word is true, and what thou hast expounded and interpreted to us is clear. Even as Paul said, hast not the seed of Abraham exalted the seed of Shem? They are all kings of the earth, but the chosen ones of the Lord are the people of Ethiopia. For theirs is the habitation of God, the heavenly Zion, the tabernacle of his law, and the tabernacle of his covenant, which he made to a mercy seat through his mercy for the children of men. For the rains and the waters from the sky, for the planted things or vegetation and the fruits, for the peoples and the countries, for the kings and nobles, for men and beasts, for birds and creeping things. And Gregory the bishop, the worker of wonders, answered and said to them, Verily, salvation hath been given to all of us Christian people, to those who have believed in Our Lady Mary, the likeness of the heavenly Zion. For the Lord dwelt in the womb of the Virgin, and was brought forth by her without carnal union. And the 10 words, Decalogue, of the law were written by the finger of God, and made in Zion the tabernacle of the law of God. And now come ye, and we will declare for the law of Moses the prophecies of the prophets, our fathers, the holy men of olden time, and the prophecies concerning Christ, our Redeemer, so that the generations of posterity may hear the interpretation or explanation of the story, and we will relate to them the narrative of the interpretation of the scriptures. We will begin then with the beginning of the book, and we will make you to understand in the Spirit, as David said, through the Holy Spirit, in the beginning the book was written because of me. And one answered and said, What is the beginning of the book? And they answered and said to him, It is the law which was written concerning Christ, the Son of God. And it said, In the beginning God made the heavens and earth, and they existed from olden time. Now the earth was formless, but there were mixed together darkness and winds and water and mists and dust. All of these were mixed together, and the Spirit of God hovered above the waters. This meaneth that by the word of God the heavens and the earth were created, and these words mean that the Spirit of God dwelt over all creation. Concerning the prophecy about Christ. Moreover, Moses proclaimed in the law and said, A prophet like myself shall rise up for you from your brethren, and hearken ye to him. And every soul that will not hearken to that prophet ye shall root out from among the people. And this he said concerning Christ the Son of God. And he also prophesied concerning his crucifixion and said, When the serpents afflicted the children of Israel, they cried out to Moses. And Moses cried out to God to deliver them from the serpents. And God said to him, Make an image of brass of a serpent and suspend it in a place where it can be known as a sign, and let everyone whom a serpent hath bitten look upon that image of brass, and he shall live. And when they failed to look at it, they died, and those who looked on it and believed lived. And in like manner was it with Christ, those who paid no heed to him and did not believe in him perished in Sheol. And those who believed and hearkened to him inherited the land of everlasting life, where there will never be pain or suffering. And now we will make known to you how they paid no heed to Christ, the word of God, when the children of Israel spake against Moses, saying, Is it that God hath spoken to Moses only? How is it that we also do not hear the word of God, that we may believe on him? And God, who knoweth the hearts of man, heard the murmurings of the children of Israel. And he said to Moses, Thou dost ask forgiveness for thy people, and yet they murmur against thee, saying, Why doth not God speak with us? And now, if they believe in me, let them come hither to me with thee, and tell them to purify themselves, and to wash their apparel, and let the great men of Israel go up to hear what commands I will give them. And let them hear my voice, and perform the commandments which I shall give them. And Moses told the children of Israel what he had been commanded, and the people bowed low before God, and they purified themselves on the third day. And the 70 elders of Israel went up into Mount Sinai, and they departed from the encampment and ascended Mount Sinai. And they were distant from each other the space of flight of an arrow, and they stood still, each facing his neighbor. Now, though there were many of them, and they used their edivers, they were not able to ascend into the cloud with Moses, and fear and trembling seized upon them, and the shadow of death enveloped them, and they heard the sound of the horn and pipes, and they felt the darkness and the winds. And Moses went into the cloud and held converse with God. And all the great men of Israel heard that voice of God, and they were afraid and quaked with terror. And because of the overwhelming terror which was in their hearts, they were unable to stand up. And when Moses came forth, they said to him, "We will not hear this word of God, so that we may not die of terror. And behold, we know that God holdeth converse with thee. And if there be anything that he should say to us, do thou hearken thereto, and declare it to us. Be thou to us a mouth in respect of God, and we will be to him his own people. Do ye not see that they denied Christ, and said, We will not hearken to that voice, so that we may not die in terror? Now Christ was the word of God, and therefore, when they said, We will not hearken to that voice, they meant, We do not believe in Christ. And again Moses spake to God and said, Show me thy face. And God said to Moses, No one can look upon my face and live, but only as in a mirror. Turn thy face to the west, and thou shalt see in the rock the mirroring of my face. And when Moses saw the shadow of the face of God, his own face shone with a brightness which was seven times brighter than the sun. The light was so strong that the children of Israel could not look upon his face except through a veil. And thereupon he saw that they did not desire to look upon the face of God, for they said to him, Make to us a veil, so that we may not see thy face. And having said these words, it is evident that they hated the hearing of his words and the sight of his face. And moreover, when Abraham took his son Isaac up into Mount Carmel, God sent down from heaven a ram for the redemption of Isaac. And Isaac was not slaughtered, but the ram which had come down from heaven was slaughtered. Now Abraham is to be interpreted God the Father, and Isaac is to be interpreted as a symbol of Christ the Son. And when he came down from heaven for the salvation of Adam and his sons, the Godhead, which had come down from heaven, was not slain, but his body which he had put on for our sakes, the earthly body which he had put on from Mary, was slain. Can ye understand and know that the likeness and similitude for the earthly being Isaac, the son Abraham, who was an offering of the will of his father, the heavenly ram became a redemption or substitute, and the son of Abraham was redeemed. And as for him who came down, the son of God, he became the redemption of the Godhead, his body for the earthly, and he died his body, the Godhead suffering in no wise and remaining unchanged, and the mortal became living in the resurrection with the Godhead. And it is clearly manifest in that Christ, the son of God, hath redeemed us. He hath magnified us men, and we must honor especially both upon the earth and in heaven this our Lady Mary, the Virgin, the Mother of God. And hearken ye to this explanation concerning the first man, who is our father Adam. Eve was created from a man, from a bone in his side. Without carnal embrace and union, she became his companion, and having heard the word of guile from being the helpmeet of Adam, she became a murderess by making him to transgress the command. And in his mercy, God the Father created the pearl in the body of Adam. He cleansed Eve's body and sanctified it and made for it a dwelling in her for Adam's salvation. She, Mary, was born without blemish, for he made her pure without pollution, and she redeemed his death without carnal union and embrace. She brought forth in heavenly flesh a king, and he slew death with his pure body, and he rose without corruption, and he hath raised up with him to immortality the throne of divinity, and he hath raised up to him, and we have exchanged the life in our mortal body and found the life which is immortal. Through the seduction of Adam, he suffered affliction, and by the patient endurance of Christ, we are all healed. Through the transgression of Eve, we died and were buried, and by the purity of Mary, we received honor and are exalted to the heights. And Ezekiel also prophesied concerning Mary and said, I saw a door in the east which sealed with a great and marvelous seal, and there was none who went into it except the Lord of hosts. He went in through it and came forth therefrom. Hear ye now this explanation. When he said, I saw a door, it was the door of the gate of heaven, the entrance of the saints into the kingdom of the heavens. And when he said, this is what in the east, he referred to her purity and her beauty. Men call her the gate of salvation, and also the east, whereto the saints look with joy and gladness, and the closeness of which he speaketh referred to her virginity and her body. And when he said that she was sealed with a great wonderful seal, she showeth plainly that she was sealed by God, the great and wonderful, through the Holy Spirit. And when he saith, none goeth through it except the Lord of hosts, he goeth in and cometh out. He meaneth the Creator of the heavens and the earth, the Creator of the angels and men and the lords. The Lord of hosts is the fruit of the Godhead, who put on our body from her, Christ. He went into and came forth from without her, without polluting her. And Moses also prophesied concerning Mary, saying, I saw a bramble bush on the Mount Sinai, which the devouring fire consumed not. And the signification of this fire is the Godhead of the Son of God. And the bramble bush, which burned without the leaves thereof, being shriveled, is Mary. Concerning the murmuring of Israel. And once again the children of Israel murmured concerning the ministration of the priest before the Lord, saying, Are we not Israel? We, the seed of Abraham, and why cannot we also offer up sacrifice like them in the tent of witness by the tabernacle of the law of God, the holy Zion, with censers and incense and the holy instruments? Why should Moses and his brother Aaron and their children alone do this? Are we not the people whom God hath chosen as much as they are? And shall we not do his will? And when Moses heard this, he said to them, Do ye whatsoever ye will. And the elders of Israel went and had made 70 censers, wherewith to censer Zion and to praise God. And they took incense and coals in the censers, and went and came into the Holy of Holies to offer up incense. And immediately they threw the incense into the censers at the first swing of them. Fire came forth from the censers, and they were burnt up straightway and melted away. And as wax melted before the face of the fire, even so did they melt away. And as grass withereth when flame approacheth, even so were they consumed, together with their instruments. And there was nothing left of them except their censers. And God said, Sanctify to me these censers for my tent, or pavilion. And they shall be used for my offerings, for they are consecrated by the death of those men. Now the censer is Mary, and Christ, the Son of God, the Godhead, is the coals, and the odor of the incense is the perfume of Christ. And through the perfume of him, apostles, the prophets, and martyrs, and monks have rejected the world and inherited the kingdom of heaven. And the chains of the censers are the ladder which Jacob saw, to which the angels clung as they went up and came down, and upon the perfume of the incense the prayers of the pure go up to the throne of God. And when the flame had burned up the sinners, the people who were kinsmen of these who had been destroyed reviled Moses and Aaron, and said to them, Ye have made our elders to perish. And they took up stones to stone Moses and Aaron. And God was exceedingly wroth with Israel, and he abominated as a filthy rag the counsel of Dathan and Abiram and the sons of Korah. And the word of God made a sign to the earth, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up, together with their companions, and their wives, and their children, and their beasts. They went down into Sheol alive, and the earth shut herself up over them. And as for the people who had been associated with them and had heard their revilings of Moses, God sent upon them a plague, and they died forthwith. And Moses and Aaron came with incense and censers, and they wept before God and entreated him for forgiveness for the people, saying, Remember, O Lord, Abraham thy friend, and Isaac thy servant, and Israel thy holy one, for we are their seed and the children of thy people. Cool thy wrath in respect of us, and make haste to hear us, destroy us not, and remove thy punishment from upon thy people. And God the merciful saw the sincerity of Moses, and had compassion upon them. And God spake to Moses, and said to him, Speak thou to this people, and say to them, Sanctify ye yourselves, and bring ye for each of the houses of your fathers a rod, and write ye the name upon it, so that ye may know their rods, thou and thy brother Aaron. Now of your houses let Aaron write upon his rod, but upon thine own rod make no mark, for it shall be a perfect miracle for the children of thy people, a vindication for the wicked, and a sign of life for all those who believe. If thou didst write thy name now with them, they would say to thee, This hath been a work of miracles from of old by the word of God. Let them say this when I have shown them a miracle by it, the rod. But for the house of thy father, write upon the rod of Aaron. Concerning the rod of Moses and the rod of Aaron. And Moses spake these words to them, and they brought a rod into each of the houses of their fathers, which they had chosen for purity. And there were 12 rods, and Moses wrote upon their rods the names of their fathers. And the rod of Aaron was written the name of Levi, and on the rod of Carmen was written the name of Judah, and on the rod of Adonias was written the name of Reuben. And on the rod of every man of all the house of Israel was written in like manner the name of his father. And God said to Moses, Carry the rods to Zion, to the tent of witness, and shut them up therein until the morning. And then take them out before the men, and give to each of them his rod, according to the houses of their fathers, whose names are written on the rods. And the man on whose rod a mark shall be found is he whom I have chosen to be priest to me. And Moses told the people these words, and they did according as God had commanded them. And then, when the morning had come, Moses took the rods, and all the elders of Israel and Aaron came. And Moses came before them, and he lifted up the rods, and brought them before all the people. And the rod of Aaron was found with the fruit and flower of an almond, which emitted a fragrant perfume. And Moses said to them, Look ye now. This is the rod which the Lord your God hath chosen. Fear ye him and worship him. And all the people bowed down before God. Now this rod is Mary, and the rod which without water burst into bloom indicateth Mary, from whom was born without the seed of man the word of God. And that he saith, I have chosen, I will make manifest a miracle, and he shall be priest to me, meaneth that God choose Mary out of all the congregation of Israel, even as David her father prophesied, saying, The Lord beloved the gates of Zion more than all the habitations of Jacob. And he further said, Marvelous is his speech concerning thee, O city of God. And when he said, More than all the habitations of Israel and her gates, he referred to the silence of her mouth, and the purity of her lips, and the praise which goeth forth from her mouth like the honey which floweth from her lips, and the purity of her virginity, which was without spot or blemish or impurity before she brought forth. And after she had brought forth, she was pure and holy. And so shall it be, even as it was, to all eternity. And in the heavens she goeth about with the angels, a pure thing. And she is the rod of Aaron. She liveth in Zion with the pot which is filled with manna, and with the two tables that were written with the finger of God. And the heavenly spiritual Zion is above them. The Zion, the making of the constitution of which are wonderful, of which God himself is her maker and fashioner for the habitation of his glory. And God spake to Moses, saying, Make a tabernacle of wood, which is indestructible by worms and rot, and cover it up with plates of fine gold, every part thereof. And the gold is the fineness of the Godhead that came down from heaven. For the Godhead comprehended all heaven and earth. And in like manner is plated with gold the tabernacle, the abode of the heavenly Zion. and the tabernacle is to be interpreted as Mary, and the wood, which is indestructible, is to be interpreted as Christ, our Redeemer. And the gomar, which is the pot of gold inside the tabernacle, is to be interpreted as Mary. And the manna, which is in the pot, is to be interpreted as the body of Christ, which came down from heaven. And the word of God, which is written upon the two tables, is to be interpreted as Christ, the Son of God. And the spiritual Zion is to be interpreted as the light of the Godhead. The spiritual pearl, which is contained in the tabernacle, is like a brilliant gem of great price. And he who hath acquired it holdeth it tightly in his hand, grasping it and hiding it in his hand. And whilst the gem is in his hand, its owner goeth into the tabernacle, and he is an inmate therein. And he who possesseth the pearl is interpreted as the word of God, Christ. And the spiritual pearl, which is grasped, is to be interpreted as Mary, the mother of the light, through whom Akratos, the unmixed, assumed in body. In her he made a temple for himself and her pure body, and from her was born the light of light, God of God, who was born of his own free will and was not made by the hand of another, but he made a temple for himself through an incomprehensible wisdom which transcended the mind of man. On another occasion, when God brought Israel out of Egypt, they thirsted for water in Kadesh, and they murmured and wept before Moses. And Moses went to God and made him to know this. And God said to him, Take thy rod and smite this rock. And Moses smote the rock lengthwise and breadthwise in the form of the cross. And water flowed forth 12 streams. And they drank their fill of water, their people and their beasts. And when they had drunk, that rock followed after them. And the rock is to be interpreted as Christ. And the streams of water as the apostles. And that which they drank as the teaching of the apostles. And the rod is the wood of the cross. And the rock is stable, as it is said in the gospel, He who buildeth upon a rock shall not be moved by demons. And again he said, I am the gate. And again he said, I am the door. And observe ye that when speaking, he distinguished between his disciples, even as he did between those who came after them. The bishops and the Christian community, Thou art the rock, he said to Peter, And upon thee I will build the Christian people. And again he said, I am the shepherd of the sheep. And he said to him, Thrice, feed my sheep. And again he said, I am the stem of the vine. And to them he said, Ye are its branches and its clusters of fruit. And the rod of Moses, by means of which he performed the miracle, is to be interpreted as the wood of the cross, whereby he delivered Adam and his children from the punishment of devils. And as Moses smote the water of the river therewith, and turned it into blood, and slew their fish, in like manner Christ slew death with his cross, and brought them out of Sheol. And as Moses smote in the air with his rod, and the whole land of Egypt became dark for 3 days and 3 nights, with a darkness which could be felt, so that the Egyptians could not rise from their couches, so also Christ, being crucified upon the cross, lightened the darkness of the hearts of men, and rose up from the dead on the third day and the third night. And as the rod of Moses changeth itself and transformed itself by the word of God, being dry yet possessing life, and possessing life yet became a dry thing, even so Christ, with the wood of his cross, made life for the Christian people who believed on him, and with the sign of the cross made them to drive away devils. For the demons and the Christians became changed. The spiritual beings became reprobates, and through transgressing the commandment of their Lord, they became exiled ones by the might of his cross. And we have become spiritual beings through receiving his body and blood in the place of those spiritual beings who were exiled. And we have become beings worthy of praise who have believed in his cross and in his holy resurrection. And as Moses smote the mountains by stretching out his hands with his rod, and brought forth punishment by the command of God, even so Christ, by stretching out his hands upon the wood of the cross, drove out the demons from men by the might of his cross. When God said to Moses, Smite with thy rod, he meant make the sign of the cross of Christ. And when God said to Moses, Stretch out thine hand, he meant that by the spreading out of his hand, Christ had redeemed us from the servitude of the enemy, and hath given us life by the stretching out of his hand upon the wood of the cross. And when Amalek fought with Israel, Moses went up into the mountain, and Aaron was with him. They went up to pray because Amalek was prevailing. And God commanded Moses and said to him, Stretch out thine hand until Israel obtaineth the power over Amalek. And it said in the Torah that the hands of Moses were held out until the sunset. But the hands of Moses became heavy, and being weary, he dropped his hands that had been stretched out. And then Israel ceased to prevail, and their enemies overcame them. And when Moses kept his hand up and stretched out straight, Amalek was overcome, and Israel put to flight and vanquished their enemy Amalek. And when Aaron and Hor saw this, they piled up stones on the right and on the left of Moses, and they made the hands of Moses to rest on the stones which they had built up. And Aaron on his right and Hor on his left held Moses up with their shoulders so that his hands might not drop from their stretched out position. And now I will explain this to you. The war of Amalek against Israel is the war of believers against the demons. And before Christ was crucified, the demons conquered the believers. But when he stretched out his hand on the wood of the cross because of the sin of Adam and his children, and when he stretched out his hand and his palm was pierced with the nails, those who were sealed with the sign of the cross of Christ conquered them, the demons. The stretching out of the hand of Moses indicated the cross of the Christ. And that Aaron and Hor builded up stones indicated the wood of the cross and the nails. And Aaron indicated the thief on the right, and Hor the thief on the left. And Amalek indicated the demons, and the king of Amalek indicated Satan. And as concerning that they, the Amalekites, were conquered, this indicated that we have conquered the demons and Satan by the resurrection of Christ and by his cross. And again, when Israel went out of Egypt, they came to bitter water, and they lacked drink because the water was bitter. And first of all, they murmured because of the bitterness of the water. And God said to Moses, Lift up thy rod and cast it into the water, and sign it with the sign of the cross right and left. Now mark what followeth. He, God, said to him, Let it become sweet. Then would the water not have become sweet? But he made manifest that by the sign of the cross everything becometh good, and bitter water becometh sweet, and that by the might of the cross of Jesus Christus every polluted thing becometh good and pleasant. And here I will declare to thee yet other matters for the rest of the prophets concerning his crucifixion. David saith, They have pierced for me my hands and my feet. Now this referreth clearly to the nails of his hands and his feet. And again he said, They made me drink vinegar for my thirst. And this showed clearly that he drank vinegar because of the sin of Adam. The breath of life that had breathed upon Adam drank vinegar, and the hand that had founded the earth was pierced with a nail. He who forsake of Adam abased himself was born, and took the form of a servant. Concerning the two servants, Now it is said that a certain king had two slaves. The one was arrogant and strong, and the other was humble and weak. And the arrogant slave overcame the humble one, and smote him, and all but slew him, and robbed him. And the king upon his throne saw them. And the king descending seized the arrogant slave, and beat him, and crushed him, and bound him in fetters, and cast him into a place of darkness. And he raised up his humble and weak slave, and embraced him, and brushed away the dust from him, and washed him, and poured oil and wine into his wounds, and set him upon his ass, and brought him into his city, and set him on his throne, and seated him on his right hand. Now the king is the truth, Christ, and the arrogant servant whom I have mentioned is Satan, and the humble servant is Adam. And when Christ saw how the arrogant servant overcame the humble one and cast him down in the dust, he came down from his throne and raised up Adam, his servant, and bound Satan in fetters in the terror of Sheol. And he seated the body of Adam upon the throne of his Godhead, and magnified him, and exalted him, and honored him, and he was praised by all the beings who he had created, the angels and the archangels, thousands of thousands and tens of thousands of spiritual beings. For he brought low the arrogant and raised up the humble, and reduced the arrogant to shame and exalted to honor the humble, and rejected the arrogant and loved the humble, and scorned the haughty and had pity on the lowly. He cast down the arrogant from his high place and lifted the poor up out of the dust. He snatched away the mighty one from his honor and raised up the poor from corruption. For with him are honor and disgrace. Whom he wisheth to honor, he honoreth, and whom he wisheth to disgrace, he disgraceth. Concerning the angels who rebelled. And there were certain angels with whom God was wroth. Now he, the knower of the heart, knew them, and they reviled Adam, saying, Since God hath shown love to him, he hath set us to minister to him. And the beast and creeping things, and the fish of the sea, and the birds of the air, and all fruits, and the trees of the field, and the heavens, and the earth also. And he hath appointed the heavens to give him rain, and the earth to give him fruits, and the sun and the moon also hath he given him. The sun so give him light by day, and the moon to give him light in the night season. He hath fashioned him with his fingers, and he hath created him in his own image. And he hath kissed him, and breathed upon him the spirit of life. And he said to him, My son, my firstborn, my beloved. And he hath set him in a garden to eat and enjoy without sickness or suffering, and without toil or labor. But he hath commanded him not to eat from one tree. And being given all these things by God, Adam hath transgressed and eaten of that tree, and he hath become hated and rejected, and God hath driven him out of the garden. And from that time Adam hath abandoned his hope, for he hath transgressed the commandment of his Creator. And God answered the angels who reviled Adam in this wise, and he said to them, Why do ye revile Adam in this wise? For he is flesh, and blood, and ashes, and dust. And the angels answered and said to him, May we declare before thee the sin of Adam? And God said to them, Declare ye his sin, and I will hearken to you, and I myself will answer you in respect of Adam, my servant. For God had worked on behalf of Adam, and God said, I created him out of the dust, and I will not cast away that which I have fashioned. I brought him forth out of non-existence, and I will not make my handiwork a laughingstock for his enemies. And those angels said, Praise be to thee, O Lord, for thou, the knower of hearts, knowest that we have reviled Adam, because he transgresseth thy commandment, that he was not to eat of one tree, after thou hast made him lord over everything which thou hast created, and hast set him over every work of thy hands. And if thou hadst not told him, and if thou hadst not commanded him not to eat of one tree, there would have been no offense on his part. And if he had eaten because of a lack of food, there would have been no offense on his part. But thy word made him to know, and thou didst say, As surely as thou eatest of this tree, thou shalt die. And he, after hearing this, made bold and ate. Thou didst not let him lack sweet fruits to eat from the garden, and thou didst not let him lack one to comfort him, and a companion like to himself. And these things we say and make known to thee, and we have revealed to thee how he hath transgressed thy commandment. And the merciful one, and the lover of mercy, answered them on behalf of Adam, and said to them, You have I created out of fire and air, with the one intent that ye should praise me. Him have I created of twice as many elements as you, of dust and water, and of wind and fire. And he became a being of flesh and blood. And in him are 10 thoughts, or intentions, 5 good and 5 bad. And if his heart inciteth him to good, he walketh with good intent. And if the devil seduceth him, he walketh with him on an evil path. As for you, ye have no other object in your minds but praise of me, with the exception of that arrogant one who produced evil, and became an evil being, and was driven forth from your assembly. And now, why do ye magnify yourselves over Adam? If ye were as he is, and I had created you of water and dust, ye would have been flesh and blood, and ye would have transgressed my commandment more than he hath done, and denied my word. And the angel said to him, Praise be to thee, O Lord. Far be it from us. We will not transgress thy commandment, and we will not oppose thy word, for we are spiritual beings for life. And he is a creature of dust, doomed to folly. And now try us well, and put us to test, so that thou mayest know whether we are able to keep thy word. And when they had vaunted themselves in this manner, God, the lover of men, said to them, If now ye go astray so far as this in transgressing my word, the wrong will be upon your own heads. For Jahannam, or hell, and fire, and sulfur, and fervent heat, and whirlwind shall be your habitation until the great day. Ye shall be kept in chains which can neither be loosened nor broken forever. But if ye keep truly my word, and ye do my commandment, ye shall sit upon my right hand and upon my left. For everyone who hath conquered is mighty, and he who is conquered shall be overpowered. Now Satan hath no power whatsoever, for he hath only what he maketh to germinate in the mind, and he cannot grasp firmly, and he cannot perform anything, and he cannot beat, and he cannot drag, and he cannot seize, and he cannot fight. He can only make thoughts to germinate silently in the mind, and him who is caught by the evil mind he prepareth for destruction. And if a man hath conquered the evil mind, he findeth grace and hath a reward which is everlasting. And to you, the body of a man, take good heed to yourselves that ye transgress not my word, and break not my commandment, and defile not ye yourselves with eating or drinking or fornication or with any other thing whatsoever, and transgress ye not my word. And straightway there were given to them with his word flesh and blood, and a heart of the children of men. And they were content to leave the height of heaven, and they came down to earth, to the folly of the dancing of the children of Cain, with all their work of the artisan, which they had made in the folly of their fornication, and to their singings, which they accompanied with the tambourine, and the flutes, and the pipes, and much shouting, and loud cries of joy, and noisy songs. And their daughters were there, and they enjoyed the orgies without shame, for they scented themselves for the men who pleased them, and they lost the balance in their minds. And the men did not restrain themselves for a moment, but they took to wife from among the women those whom they had chosen, and committed sin with them. For God hath no resting place in the hearts of the arrogant and those who revile, but he abideth in the hearts of the humble and those who are sincere. And he spake the gospel, saying, Woe be to those who make themselves righteous and despair their neighbors. And again he said, God loveth the humble, and he holdeth lightly those who magnify themselves. And straightway God was wroth with them, and he bound them in the terror of Sheol until the day of redemption. As the apostle said, He treated his angels with severity. He spared them not, but made them to dwell in a state of judgment, and they were fettered until the great day. The word of God conquered, who had fashioned Adam in his likeness or form, and those who had reviled and made a laughingstock of Adam were conquered, and the daughters of Cain with whom the angels had companied conceived, but they were unable to bring forth their children, and they died. And of the children who were in their wombs, some died, and some came forth, having split upon the bellies of their mothers, they came forth by their navels. And when they were grown up and reached man's estate, they became giants. Giants whose heights reached to the clouds, and for their sakes and the sakes of sinners, the wrath of God became quiet. And he said, My spirit shall only rest on them for 120 years, and I will destroy them with the waters of the flood, them and all sinners who have not believed the word of God. And to those who believed the word of their fathers and did his will, no injury came from the waters of the flood, but he delivered them, saying, If thou believest my word, thou canst save thyself from the flood. And Noah said, O Lord, I believe thy word. Make me to know what means I can be saved. And God said to him, Thou canst be saved from the water by wood. And Noah said, How, O Lord? And God said to him, Make thyself a four-sided ark, and build it with the work of the carpenter, and make for it three stories inside, and go into it with all thy house. And Noah believed the word of God, and made the ark, and was saved. Now hearken ye to me, and I will explain to you concerning this thing. When God gave the command, he could have given to Noah a wing like the eagle and transported him to the country of the living, with all his house, until his anger with the sinners who had not believed the word of God and the word of their fathers had abated. Or he could have lifted him up into the air, or he could have commanded the water of the flood, which was like a wall, not to approach the one mountain where he would make Noah to dwell with his sons, and not to submerge the beast and cattle which he wanted. But know ye this, God was well pleased that by means of wood which had been sanctified, the salvation of his creation should take place. That is to say, the ark and the wood of the cross. God said to Noah, Make that whereby thou shalt be saved. That is to say, the tabernacle of the church. And when he said to him, Make it four-sided, he showed that the sign of the cross was fourfold. Now the four corners of the ark are the horns of the altar. And he commanded Moses to make the ark out of the indestructible wood. He said, I will sanctify thee by that heavenly and spiritual work of my hand. And do thou sanctify thyself from filth and impurity and fornication and vindictiveness and falsehood, together with thy brother and thy house, and sacrifice to me a clean sacrifice with cleanness, and I will accept thee after thou hast sanctify thyself and thy house. Command all the people to sanctify themselves, for my holy things must be offered by holy ones. And this thou shalt seek, the tabernacle of my covenant, which I have created for my praise. And if ye come with purity of heart, with love, and with peace, without mockery and reviling, and if ye will make right your hearts in respect of me and your neighbors, I will hear your prayers, and I will listen to your petitions about everything which ye submit to me. And I will come and be with you, and I will walk among you, and I will dwell in your hearts. And ye shall be to me my people, and I will be your God in truth. Concerning him that existed in everything and everywhere. And God said to Moses, Make for me an open space before the courtyard of the tabernacle. No man who is impure sexually and unclean shall come there, and no one who is not pure. For I am there, and not only there, but in every place like thereto where my name is invoked in purity. I was with Daniel in the den of the lions, and I was with Jonah in the belly of the great fish, and I was with Joseph in the pit, and I was with Jeremiah in the well from the lake. I stand under the deepest deep, so that the mountains may not sink down under the waters, and I am under the waters, so that they may not sink down upon the fire and sulfur. I stand under the fire and sulfur, so that they may not sink down upon the winds and the rust. I am under the winds and the rusty fog, so that they may not sink down under the darkness. And I stand under the deepest darkness and under the abysses, and every created thing supported itself on me, and everything which I have created cometh to me as a place of refuge. I am above the earth, and I am at the ends of the world, and I am the master of everything. I am in the air, my place of abode. I am above the chariot of the cherubim, and I am praised everlasting by all the angels and by holy men, and I am above the heights of heaven, and I fill everything. I am above the seven heavens. I see everything, and I test everything, and there is nothing that is hidden from me. I am in every place, and there is no other God besides me, neither in the heaven above nor in the earth beneath. There is none like to me, saith God, My hand hath laid the foundation of the earth, and my right hand hath made strong the heavens. I am my Son and the Holy Spirit. Concerning the beginning, as David prophesied by the mouth of the Holy Spirit, saying, With thee was the headship on the day of might. Now, what do these words, day of might, mean? Is it not the day whereon Christ, the word of the Father, created heaven and earth? For Moses said in the beginning of the book, In the beginning God made the heavens and earth. Understand then, in the beginning meaneth in Christ. The interpretation of beginning is Christ. John the Apostle, the son of Zebedee, said concerning Christ, This is the first of or beginning, whom we have heard and seen, whom we have known, and whom our hands have felt. And we will relate to you how we have a portion with him. And ye who believe our words shall have a portion with us. And Luke the disciple said in the Acts of the Apostles, In the beginning, We make speech concerning everything, and this that he said showeth that Christ was the redemption of all, and we believe in him. And Mark the evangelist in the beginning of his book wrote, saying, The beginning of the gospel is Jesus Christ, Jesus Christos, the Son of God. And these words mean that Christ was the glad tidings for the prophets and the apostles, and that we all have participated in his grace. And again, John the Evangelist wrote, saying, In the beginning was the Word, and that Word was with God. And in another place his Word showeth this plainly. And he said, And likewise, in the beginning was God the Word. And now observe that Word of the Father in Christ, whereby he made the heavens and the earth and every created thing. It is he who created, and without him nothing that came into being. Nothing whatsoever. He spake, and they came into being. He commanded, and they were created. And the third glorious thing, hearken to it. Through the breath of his mouth he created all their host. This maketh manifest the Holy Spirit, who is clearly referred to. And what shall we say? Let us weep for them. Woe! Woe be to the Jews and to the pagans, Arami, who have wandered from the truth and have refused to submit to the love of God, with which in his goodness he hath loved men. For after Adam was rejected through his sin, he saved him by the greatness of his mercy, being crucified on the wood of the cross, his hands being pierced with nails, with his palms stretched out in humility, and his head bowed on one side. For our sakes, he, to whom suffering was unfitting, suffered in the everlasting majesty of his Godhead. He died that he might destroy death. He suffered exhaustion that he might give strength to the wearied beings of dust. Athirst he drank vinegar. He was crowned with a crown of thorns. He feared not and was not ashamed of the contumely and hatred and spitting of the polluted Jews. He suffered beatings. He was buffeted with fists. He was pierced. He was transfixed with nails. He was reviled and mocked, being God and the King of death, and the bestower of glory. And because of this, he endureth patiently all disgrace. Wearied and miserable, they made him sad when they rejected him and hated him. But strong and glorious, what could sadden him when they brought false charges against him? For he himself knew his Godhead, and he knew his glory, and he knew himself. And there was none who knew him, for he was the creator of everything, and if they had known him, they would not have crucified the Lord of praise or glory. And he said in his mercy, Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. They likened their creator to something that had been created, and they slew a sojourner who did not belong to mortal creatures, and he was not a thing that had been made with the hand. But he himself was the maker, and he himself was the creator, light of light, God of God, Son of the Father, Jesus Christos. He was the refuge, he was the feeder, he was the director, he whose domain was above what is on high, and above everything abased himself, even as Isaiah, the man of keen words among the prophets, said, He was a humble man, and his appearance was rejected. Like a root, he hid himself in parched ground. He came in the flesh, a being of the earth. Though he was the sustainer of the universe and the savior of the universe, and David ascribed beauty to him, saying, On thy beauty and in thy godliness of form. And he again he said, His form is more goodly than that of the children of men. And again he said, Graciousness is poured forth from thy lips. And again he said, Direct aright with prosperity, and reign through righteousness, and justice, and sincerity. And again he said concerning the Jews, the enemies of the truth, Thine arrows are sharp and strong in the hearts of the haters of the king. It is right that they should transfix their hearts. He said to those who did not wish me to be king, And they shall be brought before me and pierced with spears. And again Isaiah said concerning the Jews, I have sought for them and found them not. I have called to them and they have not answered me. I have loved them and they have hated me. And again David said, They returned to me evil for good, and they hated me in return for my love for them. And again Isaiah said, With their lips they profess love for me, but in their hearts they keep afar from me, and their worshipping of me is an empty thing. And as Moses said, They have moved me to wrath with their gods, and I will move them to jealousy with that which is not a nation, for they are a people whose counsel is destroyed. And those who said, We have no law, to them hath the law been given. For God is the giver of the law to everyone, and God rewarded the Jews according to their wickedness, and he treated the Gentiles according to their simplicity. For he is merciful and compassionate to those who call upon him, and who take refuge in him, and who purify themselves from all uncleanness in the church and in the tabernacle of the law of God. And he loveth those who weep and repent, even as Stephen, one of the 70 disciples, said, Now among the 70 disciples there were 7 who were chosen for service with the 12 apostles, to perform service with Silas, and Barnabas, and Mark, and Luke, and Paul. And this Stephen spake to the Jews while as he was standing up in martyrdom, and the Jews were killing him. And he said to them, as he showed them their folly in not having kept the commandment of God, Ye have not kept the Torah according to the ordinance of the angels, as ye received it. And it said in the Acts of the Apostles, when they heard this, they went mad with anger and gnashed their teeth. Now hearken ye to me in his saying, Ye have not kept the Torah according to the order of the angels. We have a form and a foreshadowing of what is in the heavens, that is to say, the heavenly and free Jerusalem, the habitation of the Most High, whereof the situation and construction are incomprehensible to mortal heart. And in it is the throne of the Most High, which is surrounded with fire, and 4 beasts bear it in their place, which is the 6th heaven. And a throne goeth up to the 7th heaven, and the habitation of the Father, and there dwelleth he whom is with his Father, and the Holy Spirit, who vivifieth everything. And the tabernacle of the church is a similitude of Jerusalem which is in the heavens. And the church of the Gentiles is a similitude of the Jerusalem which is in the heavens. Concerning the horns of the altar. Now the tabernacle symbolizeth the horns of the altar where the holy priests offer up sacrifice, whereon they place the tarapisa table, the similitude of the grave wherein he, Christ, was buried in Golgotha. And what is on the table, that is, the offering, is a symbol of the firstling, that is to say, the body of Emmanuel, or Akratos, the pure, the unmixed, which our Savior took from Mary, of the which he said to his holy apostles, Eat ye my body, whosoever eateth not of my body hath no portion with me, and no everlasting life, but he who hath eaten my body, even though he be dead, shall live forever, for he is associated with my body and my blood, and he hath become my heir. And he shall say to my Father, Our Father which art in heaven, and the father shall answer him, saying, Thou art my son. And the crown, the covering, which is above the offering, is a similitude of the stone which, with which the Jews sealed the grave. And when the priest said, Send the Holy Spirit shall be sent, and the body of our Lord shall be perfect. And when he, and when we have received, we shall be participators in the body and blood of our Lord and Redeemer, Jesus Christus, the Son of the living God, and the Holy Spirit, henceforth and forever. Speak ye then to one another, so that the Jews, who are blind in heart, and who are our enemies, and the enemies of our Lord God, may not boast themselves over us. And they say, Your gods are many, and ye worship wood. And they say, preaching openly the word of Isaiah the prophet, ye worship the half of it, and with the other half ye cook the body and eat it. Now Isaiah speaketh thus in respect of those who worship graven images and idols. And they say that we say, These are our gods, and they have created us, and that we talk to them and worship them as the Lord our God. And these also are they whom the devils lead into error in their wickedness. And David said concerning them, The gods of the heathen are devils, but God hath created the heavens. Truth and goodness are before him. More concerning the ark and the talk of the wicked. And as concerning the ark, God saved Noah in the ark, and God held converse with Abraham in the wood of Manbar, that is to say, the wood that cannot be destroyed, and he saved Isaac by means of the ram which was caught in the thicket. And he made Jacob rich by means of three rods of wood, which he laid in running water. And through the top of his staff Jacob was blessed. And he said to Moses, Make a tabernacle of wood which cannot be destroyed, in the similitude of Zion, the tabernacle of the covenant. And when David took it from the city of Samaria, he placed the tabernacle of the law in a new tabernacle, and rejoiced before it. For from the beginning God had made the tabernacle the means of salvation, and very many signs and wonders were performed through it by its form and similitude. Hearken ye now to me, and I will show you plainly how God had ordained salvation through the wood of his cross in the tabernacle of his law from the beginning to the end. Salvation came to Adam through the wood, for Adam's first transgression came through the wood, and from the beginning God ordained salvation for him through the wood. For God himself is the creator and giver of life and death, and everything is performed by his word. He created everything, and he maketh righteous him that serveth him in purity, and his pure tabernacle of law. For it is called the mercy seat, and it is also called place of refuge, and it is also called altar, and it is also called place of forgiveness of sins, and it is also called salvation, and it is also called gate of life, and it is also called glorification, and it is called city of refuge, and it is called ship, and it is called haven of salvation, and it is called house of prayer, and it is called place of forgiveness of sins for him that prayeth in purity in it, so that men may pray therein in purity and not defile their bodies. God loveth the pure, for he is the habitation for the pure. Those who come into his habitation are accepted in the holy tabernacle, and who pray to him with all their hearts. He will hear and will save in the day of their tribulation, and he will fulfill their desire, for he hath made the holy tabernacle to a similitude of his throne. But there are some among those whom ye have brought to us, who are like to us Christians, but who have not abandoned the sin which their father the devil hath made to spring up in them. And he said, Thus it is right that we should pray in Zion, the tabernacle of the law of God. She was at first, and is even now, the similitude thereof, and the fruit thereof are the mother of the Redeemer, Mary. It is right that we should worship her, for in her name the blessed the tabernacle of the law of God, and in it And it is right that we should worship Michael and Gabriel. And the Archbishop Cyril answered and said to them, And if he had said this to them, we also will say to them, What did our Lord, Jesus Christ, say when he was teaching those who believed in him? One came from outside and said to him, behold them, thy father and thy mother outside seeking thee. And Christ, the lover of men, answered and stretching out his hand towards those whom he was teaching, said, Without making any distinction or difference between man and woman, behold them, my father and my mother and my brother. Whosoever hath heard my word and hath done the will of my father, that same is my father and my mother and my sister. O thou blind-hearted Jew, canst thou not see his mercy and his love for men when he spake thus? He neither separated nor made a distinction, but he said to them, My brother, for he loveth those who love him and keep his commandment, especially the martyrs, who for his sake delivered themselves over to death, though they knew the bitterness of death, and the solitary monks who kept the commandment of God and love him with all their hearts, and he loveth them. And their graves which are built, that is to say, the martyriums and the churches which are built in their names, and the tabernacles which the bishops consecrate in their names, every one is holy in the house of the sanctuary of God, and the man who prayeth in their names God heareth. And those who pray in purity without uncleanness and blemish, and in humility and sincerity in a tabernacle which hath been consecrated, whether it be in the name of a martyr, or in the name of an angel, or in the names of the righteous, or in the name of a virgin, or in the name of holy woman, if it be consecrated, the Holy Spirit cometh down upon them and changeth the wood so that it becometh a spiritual being. In this wise God transformed the rod of Moses by his word, and it became a thing of life, and made Moses fear his Lord. And in a like manner Joseph worshipped the top of the rod of Jacob when he was before him. None forced him, but through the belief of his father he worshipped the top of his rod. And this which Moses wrote, a prophecy for the last days, so that we may know the tabernacles in the name of the martyrs and righteous men are holy, namely, when he worshipped the top of his rod. And I will also declare to you what is written concerning the pride of Pharaoh. Moses did as God commanded him and turned his rod into a serpent. And Pharaoh commanded the magicians, the sorcerers, to do the same with their rod. And they made their rods into three serpents, which by means of magic wriggled before Moses and Aaron and before Pharaoh and the nobles of Egypt. And the rod of Moses swallowed up the rods of the magicians, for these deceivers had worked the magic for the sight of eyes of men. Now that which happeneth through the word of God overcometh every kind of magic that can be wrought. And no one can find him to be evil, for it is the Holy Spirit who guideth and directeth him that believeth with an upright heart without negligence. Even as Paul said, By believing the fathers of olden time were saved. He wished to make known each by his name from Adam and Noah and Abraham to Rahab, the harlot who received the spies. And thou, O blind Jews, canst thou not understand from what thou readest in the law, that is to say, the Torah wherein thou believest, that insomuch as thou canst not perform its commandment, thou art cursed thereby. For when he said, All those who walk therein, if they do not keep what is written therein, accursed shall be they. He said it to thee. But those who believe in Christ, the Son of God, the grace of God hath chosen, saying, He who believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Concerning the belief of Abraham. And thou dost not understand that they were justified by faith, Abraham and David and all the prophets, and one after the other, who prophesied concerning the coming of the Son of God. And Abraham said, Wilt thou in my days, O Lord, cast thy word upon the ground? And God said to him, By no means. His time hath not yet come, but I will show thee a similitude of his coming. Get thee over the Jordan, and dip thyself in the water as thou goest over, and arrive at the city of Salem, where thou shalt meet Melchizedek, and I will command him to show thee the sign and similitude of him. And Abraham did this, and he found Melchizedek, and he gave him the mystery of the bread and wine, that they same which is celebrated in our Passover for our salvation through our Lord Jesus Christus. This was the desire and the joy of Abraham, and he went round the altar with Melchizedek had made, carrying branch and palms on the day of the Sabbath. See how he rejoiced in his belief, and see how he was justified by his belief. O blind Jew, who though having eyes see it not, and having ears hear it not, even as the prophet Isaiah said concerning you, their eyes are blind, and their hearts are covered with darkness, so that they may not understand, and God may not show compassion to them. A prophecy concerning the coming of Christ. And now, hearken how each one of them hath prophesied concerning him, for the narrative is pleasant to hear. Isaiah the prophet prophesied concerning his coming and said, A son is born to us, a child is given to us. Dominion is written upon his shoulder. He is God, strong in rule, king, great counselor in his name. Now the meaning of this is manifest. The Son of God is born, whose sovereignty was written down before the world was, and he is wiser than anyone else. This is what he said to thee. And again Isaiah prophesied and said, Behold, my servant whom I have chosen, on whom is the delight of my soul, and the nations shall put their confidence in him. And these words give us and understand that Christ is the Spirit of God, the Word of the Father, who put on our flesh and was born for us, and the peoples of Rome and Ethiopia and all other nations have believed in him. And he made to the people of Israel, and again he prophesied, saying, Many shall follow after thee with their loins girded up, and their backs bound with fetters, and they shall pray to thee and worship thee, for thou art God. And we have not recognized thee. Now this he spake concerning the martyrs and those who became monks in the desert and solitary monks, whose hearts were fettered with his commandment, and who prayed to him, meaning that reward was meet for both the martyrs and the solitary monks. And we did not recognize thee. Israel made itself blind and crucified him, and refused to walk in his righteousness. And again Isaiah prophesied and said, God shall come, and the heathen shall put their trust in him, and shall know him. This meaneth that Christ shall come, and the Jews shall reject him, but the heathen shall believe in him. And again he prophesied and said, Be strong, ye weak hands and tired knees, and rejoice, ye hearts, that thou art cast down, for God hath come, who shall requite and death and save us. And he shall open the eyes of the blind, and he shall make the ears of the deaf to hear, and the feet that are lame shall run, and the tongues of the dumb shall speak. These words are spoken in respect of those who err in worshipping idols, and those who are dead in sin, and those whose hearts are darkened, and of you who do not know the God that God created you. Rejoice ye this day. He hath come who will redeem the sin of Adam, and make Adam's death his own. He was crucified, being sinless. He hath killed death by means of his own death. And the blind see, and the lame walk, and the deaf hear, and the dumb speak unhaltingly. And desires all these things, the dead are raised. This is the meaning of prophecy. He was crucified, being sinless. He hath killed death by means of his own death. And the blind see, and the lame walk, and the deaf hear, and the dumb speak unhaltingly. And besides all these things, the dead are raised. This is the meaning of this prophecy. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, God shall come in the visible form, and our God will not keep silence. Thus Jeremiah prophesied and said, God shall come down upon the earth and shall walk about with men like us. Thus Ezekiel the prophet prophesied and said, I, your God, will come, and I will walk about among them, and they shall know me that I am their God. Thus David prophesied and said, Blessed is he who cometh in the name of God. He have blessed you in the name of our Lord. Thus Habakkuk prophesied and said, God shall come from the south, and the Holy One from the Mount Paran, and from the cities of Judah. Thus Elijah the prophet prophesied and said, With a new covenant shall God come to us. Thus Joel the prophet prophesied and said, The heavenly Emmanuel shall come and shall deliver the work which he hath fashioned with his own hands from the hand of the devil, the deceiver, and his devils which lead astray. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, The God of gods shall show himself in Zion. The people say, Out of Zion a man is born therein, and he, the Most High, hath founded it. Thus Solomon his son prophesied and said, Verily God shall be with men, and he shall walk about upon the earth. Thus his father David prophesied and said, He shall come down like the dew upon wool, and like the drop which droppeth upon the earth, and righteousness shall spring into being in his days. Thus Solomon his son prophesied and said, A Savior shall be born out of Zion, and he shall remove sin from Jacob. Thus Hosea the prophet prophesied and said, I will come to thee, O Zion, I will walk out in thee, Jerusalem, said God, the Holy One of Israel. Thus Micah the prophet prophesied and said, The word of God shall appear in Jerusalem, and the law shall go forth from Zion. Thus Hosea the prophet prophesied and said, God shall appear upon the earth and shall dwell with men like us. Thus Jeremiah the prophet prophesied and said, A Savior shall be sent from Zion, and he shall remove sin from the people of Israel. Thus Micah the prophet prophesied and said, God shall come from the heavens and dwell in his temple. Thus Zechariah the prophet prophesied and said, Rejoice, O daughter of Zion, behold, I am alive, and I will dwell in thee, saith God, the Holy One of Israel. Thus Micah the prophet prophesied and said, Behold, God shall come, and shall shine upon those who fear him. Son of righteousness is his name. Thus Hosea the prophet prophesied and said, God shall come upon thee, Jerusalem, and shall appear in the midst of thee. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, He shall live, and they shall give him of the gold of Arabia, and they shall pray for him continually, and he shall be the stay of all the earth upon the tops of the mountains. Thus Job the just prophesied and said, God shall walk about upon the earth, and he shall travel over the sea as upon the dry land. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, He bowed the heavens and came down. Thus Isaiah the prophet prophesied and said, Behold, the virgin shall conceive and shall bring forth a son, and she shall call his name Emmanuel. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, I brought thee forth from the womb before the star of the morning. And again he said, God said to me, Thou art my son, and I give this day brought thee forth. Thus Gideon prophesied and said, Behold, he shall come down like dew upon the earth. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, God looked down from heaven upon the children of men and from the temple of his sanctuary. Thus Moses the prophet prophesied and said, And all the children of God shall say, He is strong, for he avengeth the blood of his sons. Thus David prophesied and said, And there will I make a horn to David to rise up, and I will prepare a lamp for my anointed, and I will clothe his enemies with shame, and in him shall my holiness flourish. Thus Hosea the prophet prophesied and said, Fear not, for thou shalt not be put to shame, and be not dismayed because of thy praise. And again he said, hearken to me, my people, for my judgment is right. I will come and I will dwell with you, and the nations shall put their trust in my light, for the nations shall be the loved ones of Christ. Thus David the prophet said, "A people whom I do not know shall serve me. At the mere hearing of the ear they shall answer me." And the Jews, he said, "The children of the stranger have been false to me. The children of the stranger have become old and have traveled haltingly and they're on their path. God liveth, and blessed is my God. When he said to thee, God liveth, he speaketh of his Godhead. And when he said to thee, and blessed is my God, he speaketh concerning his putting on the flesh. And again, he speaketh concerning his putting on the flesh in Isaiah the prophet, saying, Who is the glorious one who cometh forth from Edom, Adonai, who came down from heaven and put on the things of Bosor, glorious in majesty? When he said, glorious, he referred to the sweet odor. And when he said, Adonai, he meaneth the word of the Father, who was before the world, the Son of God. When he said, he put on the things of Bosor, the glorious in majesty, he indicated clearly the body of Adam. Thus David the prophet prophesied, saying, Concerning Christian folk, declare ye to the nations that God is king, and that he hath made fast the world, so that it shall never be moved. And he also prophesied concerning his coming to the nations, and said, Before the face of God shall he come. He shall come and shall judge the earth, and he shall judge the world in righteousness, and the nations with justice. Thus Isaiah the prophet prophesied and said, The Lord of hosts hath planned to destroy the contumely of the nations, and he shall bring to nothing the nobles and the mighty ones of the earth. And the continuing his prophecy, he said, He shall come and shall build his house, and he shall deliver his people. And he added other words, saying, And at that time there shall spring from the root of Jesse one who shall be set over the nations, and the nations shall put their trust in him, and the place where he shall abide shall be glorious forever. Thus David prophesied and said, Sing ye to God who dwelleth in Zion, and declare ye to the nations his work. Thus Solomon his son prophesied and spake concerning our Savior, Emmanuel, the Son of Righteousness. He brought me forth before the hills, and before he made the lands, and set them in order, and founded me before the world, before he made the earth, and before he made the abysses, and before the water floods came forth, and the beauty of the flowers appeared, and before the winds blew. God created his work before his face, and I existed conjointly with my father. Thus his father David prophesied and said, His name was before the sun and before the moon, generation to generation. Thus his son Solomon prophesied and said, When he made strong the firmament above the clouds, and when he set in position the walls of the boundaries of heaven, and when he set the sea in its appointed place, and before he founded his throne above the winds, and when he made strong the foundations of the earth, I existed conjointly with him. I was that wherein he rejoiced continually, and day by day I exulted with him at all times before his face. Thus Job the prophet prophesied and said, The face of my God is the east, and his light is before that of the sun. The nations put their trust in him. Thus Isaiah the prophet prophesied and said, Remember ye not the things of the past, and think not about the things of olden time. Behold, I will make a new thing, which shall now spring up, so that ye may know that I make a road through the desert, and water floods in the wilderness. And the beasts of the field shall follow after me, and the young birds, and the ostriches. For I have given water in the desert, and made streams of water to flow in the wilderness, so that I may give drink to my people, and to my chosen ones whom I have gotten, so that they may declare my glory and perform my commandments. Thus Solomon prophesied and said, Who hath gone up into heaven and come down? And who hath gathered together the winds in his bosom? And who hath collected the waters in his garment? And who hath measured the water of the sea in his hand, and the heavens on the palm of his hand? And what is his name? And what is the name of his son? Thus Micah the prophet prophesied and said to the Jews, I have no pleasure in you, saith God, who ruleth all things, and I have no pleasure in your offerings, and I will accept no gift from your hands, for from the rising of the sun to the setting thereof shall my name be praised among all peoples and in all the countries. Incense shall be offered up to my great name among all peoples, said Almighty God. And again Micah the prophet said, a new covenant shall appear upon the mountain of God, and it shall be prepared upon the tops of the mountains, and it shall be exalted above the hills, and the people shall say, come ye, let us go up into the mountain of God. And many nations shall go thereto, and shall say, come ye, let us go up into the mountain of God. And they shall declare to us his way, and we will walk therein. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, hearken to me, O my people, I will speak to thee, Israel, and will bring testimony to thee. I am God thy God. Thus Moses the prophet prophesied and said, concerning the Trinity, hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one, and this is to be explained thus. Father and Son and Holy Spirit are one God, whose kingdom is one, whose dominion is one, and as one men shall worship them in the heavens and in earth, and in the sea and in the abysses, and to him he prays for ever and ever. Amen. Concerning his entrance into Jerusalem in glory. And the prophets have prophesied concerning his glorious entry into Jerusalem, and Isaiah the prophet said, shine thou, Jerusalem, thy light hath come, and the glory of God hath risen upon thee. Thus the prophet Zechariah prophesied and said, rejoice, rejoice, daughter of Zion, and let Jerusalem shout for joy. Thus David prophesied and said, out of the mouth of the children of babes thou hast prepared praise because of the enemy, so that thou mightest overthrow the enemy and the avenger. Thus Solomon prophesied and said, the children are taught by God, and the peoples rejoice within thee. Thus David his father prophesied and said, blow ye the horn in Zion on the day of the new moon, on the appointed day of our festival, for it is an ordinance for Israel. Thus Ezra the scribe prophesied and said, get ye out, make ye a festival in gladness, and say to the daughter of Zion, rejoice thou, behold, thy king hath come. Thus Isaiah the prophet prophesied and said, rejoice thou, Jerusalem, rejoice thou, behold, thy king hath come riding upon an ass, his reward is with him, and his work is before his face. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, blessed is he who cometh in the name of the Lord. Thus Jacob the son of Isaac prophesied and said, Judah, thy brethren have praised thee. Thine hand is upon the back of thine enemy, and the children of thy mother shall worship thee. And the dominion shall not be diminished from Judah, and the government shall not depart from his kin, until he shall find him who hath been waited for, and who is the hope of the nations. And he also prophesied and said, his teeth are white as snow, and his eyes are glad as wine, as with wine, and he shall wash his apparel in wine, and his tunic in the blood of clusters of grape. And again he prophesied, saying, Judah is a lion's whelp, thou hast lain down, and thou hast slept. No one shall wake him up except him that hunteth until he findeth him. Rise up from thy strong place. And again Jacob blessed his son Judah, and said to him, there is a king who shall go forth from thee, and shall wash his apparel in wine. And glorious is the place of rest of the beloved. Now by beloved Christ is meant, and by Messiah, Moshiach, Christ is meant. And Jesus meaneth Savior of the people. Now the prophets mention Christ under a secret name, and they call him the Beloved. And Isaiah spake concerning his ascension in his prophecy, saying, on that day the Beloved shall come down from heaven, and shall choose for him 12 apostles. And again he said, I have seen the ascension of the Beloved Son to the seventh heaven, and the angels and the archangels receiving him, he being very much higher than they. And David said, the Beloved is like the son of the unicorn. And again he said, and thine only one from the horns of the unicorn. And again he said, let my horn be exalted like that of the unicorn. Horns meaneth the kingdoms of the world, and unicorn meaneth he who is over his kingdom, whom no one can resist, for he is the governor of kings. He destroyeth whom he will, and he setteth up him whom he will. Even as David said, I will make thee to rejoice more than those who are mighty through their horns, which meaneth, thou art nobler than the noble kings, and thou dost rejoice. And Habakkuk prophesied, saying, horns are in his hands, and he hath placed the beloved in the strength of his power, which meaneth the psalms of the hand, wherein the life of all is held, of the holder of the dominion of kings, and pierced with nails, which Christ the beloved hath endured in the strength of his might. Concerning the wickedness of the iniquitous Jews, and the prophets prophesied concerning the wickedness of the Jews, and David said concerning it, the man of violence hunteth iniquity to destroy himself. And again he said, his sorrow shall return upon his head, and his iniquity upon his forehead. Thus Solomon his son prophesied and said, the foolish man and the man of iniquity travel by paths that are not straight. He winketh with the eye and tappeth with the foot, and he giveth a sign by movements of the fingers and motions of the lips, and he perverted his heart, meditateth evil at all times. A man who is like this will make to come tumult and murder, and the shedding of blood through double dealing, and he shall not escape the judgment. And David his father prophesied and said, they brought forth against me the word of error. He who sleepeth shall he not awake. Shall then the man of my peace, my friend, whom I trusted, who ate my food, lift up his foot against me? Thus Isaiah the prophet prophesied and said, woe be to the man of the iniquity who bringeth wrath. And again he said, let them remove the sinner, so that he may not see the glory of God. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, the sinner speaketh what will condemn him, and there is no fear of God before his eyes. Thus Solomon his son prophesied and said, the man of iniquity bringeth tumult to the city, and he willingly maketh to come destruction, and beating, and calamity which cannot be healed, for he rejoiceth in everything which God hateth. Thus prophesied Moses the prophet and said, God wisheth not to forgive him, but rather to increase vengeance upon him, and he will make punishments to rest upon him, and the curse which is written in this book shall come upon him, and his name shall be blotted out from under heaven. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, his heart is ready for slaughter. He preferred cursing, and it shall come to him. He refuseth blessing, and it shall be far from him. Thus Jeremiah the prophet prophesied concerning him and said, the man of iniquity shall be destroyed because of the love of money, and looketh upon darkness because of his fraud. Thus Job prophesied and said concerning him, his creator will destroy his fair work, and his root shall dry up under him, and his flower shall be beaten down upon him, and his memorial shall be blotted out from the earth, and his name shall be cast for far away, and men shall remove him into the darkness, so that he may not see the light, and the house of the man of iniquity shall be blotted out. Thus Hosea prophesied and said concerning him, hearken to me, O children of Israel, for there is no righteousness and no mercy and no fear of God in his heart, but falsehood and theft and murder and fornication. And David the prophet prophesied and said, Satan standeth at his right hand. And again he said, let another take his office. And Moses cursed in the law and said, cursed be every one who taketh bribes to slay innocent blood. And all the people said, Amen and Amen. Thus Habakkuk the prophet prophesied and said, the governor maketh men wise concerning their perversions of the law, and no right judgment cometh forth. For the sinner corrupteth the righteous man, and therefore a perverted judgment cometh forth. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, the sinner seeth and becometh wrathful, and he gnasheth his teeth, and it dissolved. Thus Solomon, his son, prophesied and said, "A false balance is a hateful thing to God." Thus Jeremiah prophesied and said concerning Judah, "My hire is ready or weighed for me, 30 pieces of silver." And the prophets also prophesied concerning the crucifixion of Christ. Thus Moses, the servant of God, prophesied and said, "Ye shall see your salvation crucified upon the wood, and shall not believe." Thus David prophesied and said, "Many dogs have seized me, and they drove nails through my hands and my feet, and they counted all my bones. Though they knew me, they despised me, and they divided my garments among themselves, and they cast lots for my apparel." Thus Isaiah prophesied concerning the incarnation and crucifixion of Christ, and said, "Who believeth our word, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? And we spake like a child before him, and he is like a root in parched ground. He hath no beauty and no form, and his form is more rejected and abased than that of any man. He is a broken man and a man of suffering, for he hath turned away his face, and they treat him with contempt and esteem him as nothing." Thus Solomon prophesied and said, "Let us kill the righteous man, for he is a burden to us. He set himself up against our works. He resisted our intentions continually, and we are an abomination to him because of our sins." And he continued, saying, "My son, let not wicked men lead thee astray. If they say to thee, 'Come with us, be a partner with us,' let us hide innocent blood and take plunder from him, and let there be one purse common to us all. Withdraw thyself from their footsteps, for let it not be though through thee that the birds find the net." Thus David prophesied and said, "They cast gall into my meat, and they gave me vinegar to drink to quench my thirst." Thus prophesied Isaiah the prophet and said, "He hath taken our disease and carried our sickness, and by his wound we are healed. And we saw him suffering and wounded in his pain, and he opened not his mouth in his pain, and he came to be slaughtered. Like a lamb before the shearer, he opened not his mouth in his suffering until they took away his life, and they knew not his birth. Through the sin of my people have I come even to death." Thus Jeremiah the prophet prophesied and said, "And they took the price of the honorable one, 30 pieces of silver, whom they honored among the children of Israel. And God said to me, 'Cast it into the melting pot, and test it, and see if it be pure.' And they gave it for the field of the potter, as God hath commanded me, I will speak." Thus Isaiah the prophet prophesied and said, "They counted him with the sinners, and brought him to death." Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, "Those who hate me wrongfully are many, and they have rewarded me with evil for good." Thus Zechariah the prophet prophesied and said, "They shall look upon him whom they have crucified and pierced." Now there are still very many passages which have been written, and many prophecies which might be mentioned concerning his coming, and his crucifixion, and his death, and his resurrection, and his second coming in glory. But we have only mentioned a few of the prophecies of the prophets. We have mentioned one of each kind, so that ye may hear and believe and understand, even as it is said in the Acts of the Apostles, "By the gospel thou hast guided us, and by the prophets thou hast comforted us, for the words of the prophets make right the faith of those who doubt." Concerning his resurrection. And the prophet David also prophesied concerning his resurrection and said, I will arise, saith the Lord, and I will make salvation and manifest it openly. And again he said, "Rise up, O Lord, and judge the earth, for thou shalt inherit among the nations." And he also prophesied and said, "Rise up, O Lord, help us and deliver us from thy name's sake." And again he said, "Let God arise, and let his enemies be scattered, and let his enemies flee from before his face." And he also prophesied and said, "God hath risen up like one who hath woke up from sleep, and like a mighty man who hath left his wine. Thus Isaiah the prophet prophesied and said, He will remove sickness from his soul, for he hath not committed sin, and falsehood hath not been found in his mouth. And to him has served righteousness and good will, he show light, and he will justify them. And he shall do away the sins of many, for he hath not committed sin, and falsehood is not found in his mouth. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, For my soul shall not be left in hell. Thus Solomon his son prophesied and said, The son of the righteous shall arise, and shall travel towards the right, and shall return into his place. Concerning his ascension and his second coming. Thus all the prophets and many of the early fathers prophesied concerning his ascension and his second coming to judge the living and the dead. And David said concerning his resurrection, He hath gone up into the heights. Thou hast made captive captivity, and hast given grace to the children of men. And he also said, Having gone forth, I will come back, and I will return from the abyss of the sea. And again he said, Sing ye to God who hath gone up into the heavens which are opposite the morning. Thus Amos the prophet prophesied and said, The Messiah, who made the time of the morning, hath come and is exalted from the earth into the heights, and his name is God who ruleth all things. Thus prophesied David the prophet and said, Thou art exalted, O Lord, by thy might, and we will praise and hymns thy strength. Thus prophesied Zechariah the prophet and said, His foot standeth on the Mount of Olives, to the east of Jerusalem, and he rideth upon the cherubim, and he flieth upon the wings of the winds. Thus David said, Open ye the gates of the princes, and let the doors which were from the creation be opened, and the King of glory shall come. Who is the King of glory? Who is this King of glory? God, the mighty and strong one, God, the mighty one in battle. And he also made known and said, Open ye the gates of princes, and let the doors which were from creation be opened. And the King of glory shall come. Who is the King of glory? The Lord God of hosts is this King. And again, concerning his coming, he shall judge the living and the dead. He to whom belongeth glory forever and ever. Amen. Thus Zechariah the prophet prophesied and said, That the day of the Lord, may God, shall come, and all his saints with him. Thus David the prophet prophesied and said, God spake once, and this according to what I have heard, compassion belongeth to God, and thine, O Lord, is the power, for thou wilt reward every man according to his work. Thus spake Daniel the prophet and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, there came one like to the Son of Man, to the Ancient of Days, and there were given to him dominion and glory and sovereignty, and all the nations and peoples and countries shall serve him. And his dominion shall have no end for ever and ever. Amen. And all the prophets prophesied, and nothing that hath happened hath been without the prophecy of the prophets. And they have declared everything that hath happened, and what shall happen, what hath been done, and what shall be done, and that which belongeth to the times of old, and that which belongeth to the latter days, up to the second coming. And this they have done, not only by what they have prophesied and declared, but together with their prophecies they have given manifestations of him in their bodies. And there was a famine in the land of Canaan. And our father Abraham went down to Egypt, and came back with much riches and honor without blemish. And in like manner our Redeemer went down and delivered the church, the assembly of the nations. And he went up again, having gotten honor and praise. How the prophets foreshadowed him in their persons. Isaac commanded his father, saying, Bind me. And he was offered up as a sacrifice, though he did not die, being redeemed by the ram which came down from heaven. And in like manner the Son of God was obedient to his father, even to death. And he was bound with the love of men. And he was nailed to the cross and was pierced, and the Son of God became our ransom, and his Godhead suffered not. Thus Jacob his son departed to the land of Laban, the country of his mother's brother, with his staff only, and there he made many cattle, and acquired beasts, both clean and unclean, and he begot 12 sons, and he revealed baptism, and returned to his own country, where he received a blessing from Isaac his father. And in like manner our Lord Christ came down from heaven, the word of Godhead by itself. And the staff of Jacob wherewith he pastured his sheep is our Lady Mary, our salvation. And moreover, the staff signifieth the wood of the cross, whereby, being crucified upon it, he redeemed his flock, and took possession of us from among the Jews, and the heathen, and the Gentiles. And he chose for himself 12 apostles, and they made the people believe in all the earth and in every country, and he went to the heaven, to heaven to his father. Thus Moses departed to the country of Midian, and there he held converse with God, who made him to learn and to know the belief in the resurrection from the dead of his fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And by means of his staff, he endowed him with the power to perform miracles, and he begot 2 sons. And he showed it clearly that we shall be saved by the Trinity. And as the mouth of God proclaimed, I am the God of Abraham, this of the father, and the God of Isaac, this of the son, and the God of Jacob. When he said this it is of the Holy Spirit, indicating the Trinity clearly and plainly. I am not God of the dead, but the God of the living, for they are all alive with God. And by this the resurrection of the God is to be understood. Jonah was swallowed up and cast into the belly of the great fish, and our Redeemer went down into the heart of the earth, and rose again the third day, and Daniel was cast into the pit of the lions, and the King of the Lord sealed it with their seals, and he rose up therefrom it without the lions devouring him. And similarly our Lord was cast into the grave, and the Jews sealed it with their seals, imagining that they were sealing up the rising of the sun so that it should not shine. O ye foolish, wicked, blasphemous, blind, and weak-minded men, would ye assert that the spirit of life should not appear and come forth? And the Jews were to shame, and he went forth to illumine us who have believed upon him. Joseph was sold by the hand of his brethren, and our Lord was sold by the hand of Judah, and Joseph, where he was sold, delivered his brethren from the famine. And Christ hath delivered us who believed upon him, and hath made us his heirs and his brethren. And as Joseph gave an inheritance to his kinsfolk in the land of Goshen, so shall Christ give to his righteous ones a habitation, an everlasting inheritance. And moreover, in order that ye may know and understand and be certain about the resurrection of the dead, I will give you a sign which ye shall understand by the guidance of his word. When Abraham had come to the land of his inheritance, he brought first all a tomb wherein to gather together the dead bodies of his kinsfolk, and his children, and his wife, so that he might join them in the resurrection. And there he buried his wife Sarah, and he himself was buried, for he was a prophet, and he knew that he would be raised up with his kin. And Isaac and Rebekah his wife were also buried there, and it remained their possession from the time when Jacob went down to the land of Egypt with 77 souls, because of the famine, and because of Joseph his son was there, until their number became 600,000 marching men who were equipped for war, without reckoning women and children. And Jacob died in Egypt at a good old age, and he said to Joseph his son, I adjure thee by the life of my father and by my God, who is the renewer of my life, that thou bury me not in this country, but in the tomb of my fathers, so that my death may be with them, and my life subsequently with them. Know then by this similitude of the word. And Joseph his son carried Israel and buried him by the grave of his fathers, and he reverenced the oath which Jacob made him to swear. And again, when Jacob fell sick in Egypt, he called his brethren and his children and made them to swear that they would not leave his bones in the land of Egypt, and said, When God make it to return, take ye my bones with you and mingle them in the grave of my fathers. Concerning the chariot and the vanquisher of the enemy. And the archbishops, or patriarchs, answered and said to Gregory, The worker of wonders, behold now, we know well, and thou hast made us to understand that the kings of Ethiopia have become glorious and great through Zion, and the king of Rome also have become great because of the nails of the cross that Helena made into a brittle, which had become the vanquisher of the enemy for the king of Rome, and the chariot belonged to the king of Ethiopia, and it hath vanquished his enemy. And tell us also how long the vanquisher of the enemy shall remain with the king of Rome, and the chariot containing Zion with the king of Ethiopia. Tell us, for God hath revealed to thee what hath been and what shall be, vision and prophecy like Moses and Elijah. And Gregory answered and said to them, I will reveal to you concerning the king of Rome, when he shall transgress and shall provoke God to wrath in the faith. This faith which we have ordered and laid down shall a king transgress who shall come in Rome, and there shall be associated with him a certain archbishop, and they shall change and pervert the word of the 12 apostles, and they shall cast it aside in the desire of their hearts, and they shall teach that what they wish, and they shall turn the scriptures to suit their own nature, even as the apostle said, they have behaved themselves like the people of Sodom and Gomorrah. And our Lord said to his disciples in the gospel, Guard ye yourselves against those who shall come to you in the apparel of sheep, and who are inwardly wolves that tear. And when they have destroyed the faith, the vanquisher of the enemy shall be taken away from them, and there shall be none of those who have changed our faith who shall sit upon the throne of Peter. And the bowels of their archbishops shall be emptied out if they have taken their seat upon it in perverted faith. For the angel of God hath been commanded to protect the throne of Peter in Rome, and God shall take away the vanquisher of the enemy from the king who shall not guard the faith, and the Persians shall make war upon him and defeat him. And it seemeth to me that his name is Marcion, the apostate, and the king of Persia, whose name is Heraneos, shall conquer him, and the king shall carry him away together with his horse. And by the will of God, the horse on which is the vanquisher of the enemy shall be stirred up, and shall go into the sea and perish therein. But the nails shall shine there in the sea until Christ shall come again in great glory upon a cloud of heaven together with power. Now this hath God showed me in the pit. And as concerning the king of Ethiopia and Zion, the bride of heaven, and her chariot whereby they move, I will declare to you that which my God hath revealed to me and hath made me to understand. Ethiopia shall continue in the orthodox faith until the coming of our Lord, and she shall in no way turn aside from the word of the apostles, and it shall be so even as we have ordered until the end of the world. And one answered and said to the worker of wonders, Gregory, now when Samalial cometh, who is the false Christ, Antichrist, will faith of the people of Ethiopia be destroyed by his attack? And Gregory answered and said, Assuredly not. Hath not David prophesied, saying, Ethiopia shall make her hands come to God? And this is that, he said, meaneth that the Ethiopians will neither pervert nor change this our faith and what we have ordered, and the faith of those who were before us, the teachers of the law of the apostles, concerning the return of Zion. And the tabernacle of the law of God, the holy Zion, shall remain here until the day when our Lord shall dwell on Mount Zion. And Zion shall come and appear to all prepared with three seals, even as Moses gave her, as it saith in the old law, and in the new, at the testimony of two or three witnesses, everything shall stand. And then said Isaiah the prophet, The dead shall be raised up, and those who are in the grave shall live For the dew which cometh from thee is their life, and when the dead are raised, his mercy whereby he watereth the earth shall cease. They shall stand up before him with the works which they have done, and Enoch and Elias shall come, being alive, so that they may testify, and Moses and Aaron from the dead shall live with everyone, and they shall open the things that fetter her, Zion, and they shall make to be seen the Jews, the crucifiers, and they shall punish them and chide them because of all that they have done in perverting the word of God. And the Jews shall see what he wrote for them with his hand, the words of his commandment, and the manna wherewith he fed them without toil on their part, and the measure thereof, the Gomor, and the spiritual Zion, which came down for their salvation, and the rod of Aaron, which blossomed after the manner of Mary, concerning the judgment of Israel. And he shall answer and say to them, Why did ye deny me, and entreat me evilly, and crucify me, seeing that I did all this for you, and that my coming down from heaven I delivered you from Satan, and from the slavery of Satan, and that I came for your sakes? Look ye, and see how ye pierced me with the nails, and thrust the spear through me. And the 12 apostles shall be raised up, and they shall pass judgment upon them, and shall say to them, We would have made you hear, but ye would not hear the prophecy of the prophets, and the preaching of us, the apostles. And the Jews shall weep and repent, when it shall be useless to do so, and they shall pass into everlasting punishment, and with the devil, their father, who had directed them, and his demons, who had led them astray, and with the wicked, they shall be shut in. And those who have believed, and who have been baptized in the Holy Trinity, and have received his body and his blood, shall become his servants with their whole heart, for there is no one who can hate his body altogether. The body of Christ cried out in our body, and he hath compassion because of his body and blood, for they have become his sons and his brethren. And if there be some who have sinned, they shall be judged in the fire according to the quantity of their sins. He whose burden of sin is light, his punishment shall be light, and he whose burden of sin is heavy, exceedingly great shall his punishment be. One day with God is as a period of 10,000 years. Some there shall be who shall be punished for a day, and some for half a day, and some for 3 hours of a day, and some for 1 hour of a day, and some there shall be who shall be tested, and who shall be absolved from their transgressions. Concerning the chariot of Ethiopia. And the archbishops answered and said to Gregory, the worker of wonders, Behold now, thou hast told us concerning the vanquisher of the enemy of Rome, and now tell us of the chariot of Ethiopia, and whether it shall remain henceforward to the coming of Christ, as thou hast told us concerning Zion, and concerning the faith of the people of Ethiopia, and likewise in their chariot shall remain. And Gregory said to them, It shall assuredly not disappear. And again, hearken ye to me, and I will declare this to you. A few Jews shall lift up their heads against our father in Nagram and in Armenia, and in the days after this. And this God will do by his will, so that he may destroy them. For Armenia is a territory of Rome, and Nagram is a territory of Ethiopia. Concerning the king of Rome and the king of Ethiopia. And the king of Rome, and the king of Ethiopia, and the archbishops of Alexandria, now the men of Rome were orthodox, were informed that they were to destroy them, and they were to rise up to fight, to make war upon the enemies of God, the Jews, and to destroy them, the king of Rome, Enya, and the king of Ethiopia, Phinehas, and they were to lay waste their lands and to build churches there, and they were to cut pieces Jews at the end of this cycle in twelve cycles of the moon. Then the kingdoms of the Jews shall be made an end, and of the kingdom of Christ shall be constituted until the advent of the false Messiah. And those two kingdoms, Justinius, the king of Rome, and Caleb, the king of Ethiopia, met together in Jerusalem, and their archbishop was to make ready offerings, and they were to make offerings, and they were to establish the faith in love, and they were to give each other gifts and salutations of peace. And they were to divide between them the earth from the half of Jerusalem, even as we have already said at the beginning of this book. And for love's sake, they were to have jointly the royal title of king of Ethiopia. They were to be mingled with David and Solomon their fathers, the one whom in faith they chose by lot to be named from the kings of Rome, was to be called king of Ethiopia, and the king of Rome likewise was to bear the name of king of Ethiopia, and he was to have part in the lot whereby he should be named with David and Solomon their fathers, after the manner of the four evangelists, and the fourth, the one whom they were to choose each in his own country. And thus, after they had become united in a common bond, and had established the right faith, they were to determine that the Jews were no longer to live, and each of them was to leave his son there, and the king of Ethiopia was to leave there his firstborn son, whose name was Israel, and was to return to his own country in joy. And when he came to his royal house, he was to give abundant thanks to God, and to offer up his body as an offering of praise of his God, and God shall accept him gladly, for he shall not defile his body after he hath returned, but he shall go into a monastery in purity of heart, and he shall make king his youngest son, whose name is Gabra Maskel, and he himself shall shut himself up in a monastery. And when one hath told this to the king of Nagram, the son of Caleb, he shall come in order to reign over Zion. And Gabra Maskel shall make his armies to rise up, and he shall journey in a chariot. And they shall meet together at the narrow end of the Sea of Libya, and shall fight together. And on the same night the two of them shall pray from sunset until dawn, when the fight waxeth strong upon them. And when they have cried out to him with tears, God will look under the prayer of both of them, and the penitent prayer of their father, and will say, this one is the elder, and he hath stood up to perform the will of his father, and that one, the younger, hath loved his father, and hath prayed to God for him. And God will say to Gabra Maskel, choose thou between the chariot and Zion, and he will cause him to take Zion. He shall reign openly upon the throne of his father, and God will make Israel to choose the chariot. And he shall reign secretly, and he shall not be visible. And he will send him to all those who have transgressed the commandment of God. And no one shall build houses, and they shall live in tents. And none shall suffer fatigue and laboring, and none shall suffer thirst on the journey. And their days shall be double of those of ordinary men. And they shall use bows, and shall be double of those, and bows and arrows, and shall shoot at and pierce him that God hateth. Thus hath God made for the king of Ethiopia more glory and grace and majesty than for all the other kings of the earth, because of the greatness of Zion, the tabernacle of the law of God, the heavenly Zion. And may God make us to perform his spiritual good pleasure, and deliver us from his wrath, and make us to share his kingdom. Amen. And they answered and said to him, verily, thou hast spoken well, for thus was it revealed to thee by the help of the Holy Spirit. Thou hast told us everything which hath taken place, and thou art in agreement with the book of Domitius of Rome, and thou hast prophesied also what shall happen to the two cities, the brides of Christ, the churches, Netzia and Arcadia and Marena and Ethiopia, the great cities of God, wherein pure sacrifices and offerings shall be offered up at all times. May God show us his grace, the blessing of all the saints and martyrs be with us forever and ever. Amen. Christ is our King, and in Christ is our life forever and ever. Amen and amen. In the Arabic text, it is said, we have turned this book into Arabic from a Coptic manuscript belonging to the throne of Mark the Evangelist, the teacher, the father of us all. We have translated it from the 409th year of mercy in the country of Ethiopia, in the days of Gabra Maskel, the king, who is called Lalibela, in the days of Abba Georges, the good bishop. And God neglected to have translated and interpreted it into the speech of Abyssinia. And when I had pondered this, why did not Abales and Abal Farog, who edited or copied the book, translate it? I said this, it went out in the days of Sagwa, and they did not translate it because this book says, those who reign not being Israelites are transgressors of the law. Had they been of the kingdom of Israel, they would have edited or translated it. And it was found in Nazareth. And pray ye for me, your servant Isaac, the poor man, and chide ye me not because of the incorrectness of the speech of the tongue. For I have toiled much for the glory of the country of Ethiopia, and for going forth of the heavenly Zion, and for the glory of the king of Ethiopia. And I have consulted the upright and God-loving governor Yaibika Exi, and approved and said to him, to me, work, and I worked, God helping me, and he did not requite me according to my sins. And pray ye for your servant Isaac, and for those who toiled with me in the going out, production of this book, for we were in sore tribulation. I and Yamharana Ab and Hezba Krestos, and Andrew and Philip, and Machari Ab, may God have mercy upon them, and may he write their names in the book of life, in the kingdom of heaven, with those of all the saints and martyrs, forever and ever. Amen.